Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Welcome here tonight to Cardine's Field in Newport, Rhode Island, where tonight the Newport Dolls will be taking on the Danbury Westerners in Game 2 of the six-game season series, the first to be played here at Cardine's Field. Of course, Danbury defeated the Newport Dolls last week up in Danbury in southwestern Connecticut. The Newport Dolls looking for revenge here tonight. They'll send John DeShirt on the hill as their starting pitcher. We'll have much more coming up shortly. You're watching the NECBL Broadcast Network, brought to you by the Tigers TV crew out of Tiverton High School and the Newport Gulls Baseball Club. I'm Nick Lemire, bringing you this game from Cardine's Field. We have a full pregame show and a great baseball action coming up next. It's June 22nd, 2006, a lovely Thursday evening here in downtown Newport, Rhode Island. Much more so to come. Newport Gulls field manager Mike Coombs is next here on the NECBL Broadcast Network. And back here once again in Cardine's Field in Newport, Rhode Island. Happy to be joined by Newport Gulls field manager Mike Coombs. Coach.
Hey, Nick. How you doing, brother?
Not too bad. How are you doing today?
Good. I'm doing real good. Beautiful day here in Newport.
It was a tough loss up in Torrington, Connecticut last night for the Gulls. It was a very close game all along. Not a very sloppy game. It's had some timely hitting, but just not enough to get it done.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, it was sloppy on our part. We committed errors, we made mental base running mistakes, and it was just not a good showing by the Gulls. They beat us 6-4, you got to take your hats off to them. They beat us.
So what should be your plan of attack against Torrington the rest of the season to try and keep that from happening again?
You just try to go out and play good mental baseball, you know, do the mental things that, you know, make it work. Get the runner over, make sure, you know, on a double play ball, you get the lead runner, you know, just the little things, the fundamental things.
So you have a pregame discussion with the entire team a little while ago. Did you discuss that with them?
Yeah, we discussed that among a few other things that are, you know, confidential to team stuff. But, we had a little talk.
And John Juicy is no longer with the team?
No, John is not, and we sure appreciated his services. He was a temporary player and did a heck of a job for us.
So you have John DeShirt on the mound tonight for Newport against these Danbury Westerners.
10-4, yeah. Big John DeShirt's going to get the ball tonight and see how far he can go.
Now, Danbury did defeat the Newport Gulls last time around, looking for revenge here tonight. How do you think that the Gulls bats are going to fare here from this home crowd?
Well, as usual, I hope they fare big time. You know, we perform pretty well in this ballpark, and I hope we continue to perform well.
Now, what's the rotation look like? You have a road trip up to Manchester, Connecticut tomorrow, and then finally a weekend off after this 12 straight game stretch.
Yeah, we got Paul Nardozzi going tomorrow night against Manchester, and then we have Saturday and Sunday off, and then we come back on Monday, and we'll have Pat McEnany pitching Monday night, and Jeff Bellevue will throw Tuesday, and then we'll have another day off on Wednesday.
Good luck tonight. Newport Gulls field manager Mike Coombs.
Thanks, Nick. Take care.
Thank you for joining us. That's our pregame visit with Mike Coombs. Starting lineups are next, as well as the national anthem and the remainder of the pregame show here on the NECBL Broadcast Network.
We're
once again at Cardine's Field. And we're getting ready for baseball here with the starting lineups for the visiting Danbury Westerners. Here is Brett Franklin.
Thank you very much, Nick. As we look at the Danbury Westerners coming into this game at 4-7 on the year, they'll start it off with Mo Rivera at shortstop, Brian Keeney in right field, John Delaney in left field, Brian Mahoney batting cleanup and at first base. Frank Pesanello is the designated hitter and batting fifth. Chris McCaslin at second base, batting sixth. Brad Pippa batting seventh and catching. Dan Biedenharn is batting eighth and playing third base. And Randy Ray is the center fielder and will bat ninth.
For the home Newport Gulls here, Matt Bouchard will bat second base in leadoff spot, batting second. Jeff Miller, the third baseman. In the third spot tonight, Scott Brown is in center. First baseman Jim Murphy bats cleanup once again. Chris Dominguez has been delegated to the designated hitter spot for tonight. Andy Lentz will be in left field for the first time this season. Brian Mitchell shifts over to right for the first time. And Jet Ruiz will be catching in for John Malacone, who has a night off. Rounding out the order for the home Newport Gulls, Ryan Arcadier, his first game here in a Newport Gulls uniform, his first day of eligibility today, will be starting at shortstop tonight and in the number 9 spot. The starting pitcher for the Newport Gulls tonight will be John DeShirt. DeShirt making his second start of the season and his third overall appearance. We'll tell you more about him in a moment. First, the starting pitcher for the Danbury Westerners.
And tonight's starting pitcher will be Luke Calzone. Calzone is 0-1 on the air with a 5.79 ERA, a hard-throwing left-hander. He's making his third start of the year and looking for some run support tonight, and that's going to be the key to the game for the Danbury Westerners, to get the run support for their pitching. They've had some outstanding pitching in the past three games, and we'll need the run support here tonight against Newport.
Well set. Here's the first pitch of the ball game. It's missing low, ball one from John DeShirt. So DeShirt, who has a 1-0 record in two appearances, one game start, he's pitched 8 1/3 innings thus far this season, giving up 8 hits. His next delivery, the lefty, throws, and it's a ground ball chopper up with it. The third baseman and fires to first. That was Jeff Miller at third. Of course, Miller normally the second baseman for the Newport Gulls, but a big infield and outfield shift. Newport Gulls manager Mike Coombs has a whole different lineup tonight for the Gulls, and Miller, the third baseman, fields cleanly to first, one down here.
Yeah, DeShirt really jammed Mo on that inside pitch and got a slow roller to Miller over at third for the quick out, as Brian Keeney's going to step to the plate.
Brian Keeney, right fielder for the Danbury Westerners, stands in, the lefty DeShirt, ready his pitch. That hit him, looked like hit him where he carries his wallet. And the Westerners have their first runner of the ball game here in the first with one out.
Yeah, Brian, nice job by Brian just taking that one right inside and getting the base runner on first. That's what Danbury needs to do, as we said in the opener. The Danbury Westerners need to get runs across the plate and need to jump out early, especially on this Newport team. And hopefully John Delaney can do it right here.
John Delaney, starting left fielder tonight for the Westerners. Oh, I have an opportunity here to get things going for them early. The pitch from DeShirt. Fastball in the outside corner, a called strike. Delaney, batting 279, coming into the game tonight. In 11 games started, he has 7 runs on 12 hits. He's knocked in 5, still looking for his first home run of the season. A lead at first for Keeney. DeShirt comes to the set, to the plate. There's a fastball at the knees. And behind the count is Delaney, nothing in two. Umpires for tonight's game, Rod Adams calling balls and strikes behind the plate, and John Wilkins around the bases here tonight. Once again, from the set, DeShirt's pitch. Up and away, ball one. Didn't chase an off-speed pitch.
You talk about home runs earlier, Nick. The Westerners only have one as a team, and that was Frank Pesanello.
And that's very surprising considering the small dimensions of the Westerners' home ballpark.
Yeah, Rogers Park, and they've just haven't been able to get one out there yet. So, as you mentioned, hopefully Delaney can look for one here.
The 1-2. Swing and a miss. Strike 3. Jet Ruiz in for Malacone tonight holds on to it. And that's the second out of the inning.
Looked like an inside curveball on Delaney and just was right at his feet and took a big hack at it and missed. So big strikeout right there.
Thank you.
Ryan Mahoney, cleanup hitter for the Westerners, to bat now against Deshirt here, who on the season now has 5 strikeouts. He's walked 4 men. He's now hit 2 batters, including the this inning here. He's hit 1 here. He stands in at first. Keeney, a lead, he goes. The pitcher swung on and missed. Ruiz's throw into second is in time. Caught stealing is Brian Keeney for the out. The retires the side. The Gulls get a base runner but lose him quickly. After half an inning, the Westerners nothing. The Newport Gulls coming up here on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Back here now at Cardines Field, we go to the home half of the first inning. Leadoff batter for the Newport Gulls here will be Matt Bouchard in his typical leadoff spot. Luke Calzone's first pitch of the last half of the first is on the inside corner, a called strike. So Calzone, a lefty, lefty-lefty matchup here tonight with Deshirt, a left-hander for the Gulls, the 0-1. Swinging a foul tip around the plate area, fielded by the on-deck batter, Jeff Miller, who's up in the lineup.
Hey, Nick, Matt's hitting 316 against left-handed pitching this year.
Bouchard. Of course, Newport Gulls field manager Mike Coombs very mindful of the opposing team starter, whether he's a lefty or a righty. The 0-2 is up and inside, ball one. Nick Lehmer, Brett Franklin, and Tim Wine here in the broadcast booth for tonight's ball game here on the NECBL Broadcast Network. If you're listening to the game live, remember you can also watch it live on teamline.cc, NECBL.com, NewportGulls.com. All those websites will point you in the right direction. The 1-2 is outside, ball two. Of course, all NECBL action will be broadcast live this season throughout the league. We're here in the first, so we have no score here at Cardines Field in Newport as the Westerners play the Gulls. Calzone sets and deals at 2-2, is outside, ball three, a full count now on Matt Bouchard.
Bouchard's hitting 280, third on the team, leading the teams in runs scored with 8.
Bouchard taps the plate, stands in, the payoff pitch, swing and a drive to right. This one will go foul. Over the warehouse, over the pub to the right, and out of play.
It looks like Calzone's really trying to pick that outside corner on the outer half of the plate as he's been working on that. It looks like 2 straight pitches have been thrown in on the outside. So, and then Bouchard able to foul that last pitch off and get that count full.
Brief delay here. Bouchard may have cracked his bat. How about that defensive alignment for the Westerners, Brett?
Well, it'll in the outfield, it's going to be from left to right, Delaney, Ray, and Keeney. Dan Biedenhardt, the third baseman. Mo Rivera at shortstop. McCaslin at second base. Mahoney at first. Pippa is the catcher, and Calzone is pitching.
So Bouchard returns. He's got a new bat, and we're ready once again. Full count on him. Luke Calzone winds, kicks, deals. Swing and a ground ball, come back right over the mound. Pass Calzone into center field, a base hit. Newport Gulls get their leadoff man on for Jeff Miller.
Yeah, nice piece of hitting, sends it right up the middle. Nobody there covering behind the bag to get the leadoff hitter. And you were talking about, as we were talking about the defensive alignments, Danbury as a whole has the fielding percentage of .958, 19 errors on the season, and most of them have been careless errors, going back to back-to-back games with North Adams last night, Tuesday and Wednesday.
Calzone working out of the set now with a throwback to first, and standing is Bouchard. Matt on the season for the Newport Gulls. As far as stolen bases is concerned, 2 for 4. He has been thrown out twice. He has attempted twice as many times as just about anybody else. The pitch is swung on, laced into right center, a base hit. Bouchard hits second, he'll go into third. And will be held up there as it's recovered in up there by Brian Keeney. And the Newport Gulls have runners at the corners on 2 hits here with nobody out.
A nice piece of hitting right there by Miller as he sent that one into right center field. Randy Ray played that one really nice, took it on the hop, spun around and threw it off to the cutoff man before any damage is done early here. So Calzone in a bit of trouble. here early as nobody out with two on with the runners on the corner as you get into the meat of the order for the Newport Gulls.
I think Scott Brown's new intro music is playing as we go. That's new here at Cardines Field. In the background, you could hear some Western music. Of course, the Danbury Western is playing here tonight. I don't know if that's good luck or bad luck for Brown. That intro music is probably a new feature here for the batters, which we haven't seen since last season up until this point, as they expand their offerings here at Cardines for the fans. And a very good crowd already on hand here in the last of the first. Runners at the corners. From the set calzone, his pitch to Scott Brown. Fastball on the inside corner, called strike. This is a very dangerous lineup to have runners at the corners with nobody out. You have Brown, Murphy, and Dominguez due up right now. The three of them lead the league in home runs with three each. Brown stands in from the set calzone. His 0-1 delivery instead of throwback to first, and quickly standing is Bouchard, is Miller. He wasn't very far off the bag. Jeff Miller, not a real base stealing threat.
And we'll see how Calzone reacts early here as the Danbury bullpen a little thin, especially after the 12-inning affair with North Adams on Tuesday night.
Nothing and one, the pitch. Missing ball, a ball low. Is that a slider from Calzone?
Yeah, it looked like it. He's been throwing a little mix of sliders and breaking balls so far here early, and fastball, the Newport hitters have just been crushing him into the outfield. So trying a little bit different here as Calzone trying to get out of this jam early here in the first.
Stiff wind blows in from behind us here, southwest wind here tonight. Blowing about 10 to 15 miles per hour. The 1-1 is a fastball missing up and away, ball two.
Scott Brown coming off a good night last night, going 3-for-5 with two RBIs last night in the loss to Torrington.
Runners at the corners will take their leads. 2-1, the count on Brown. The pitch, and instead of another throw over to first, and Miller's back standing. Scott Brown, two nights ago in the finale of a two-game homestand here at Cardines Field, hit two home runs, number two and number three in the season for him. All of his home runs have come at home. The 2-1. Swing and a drive into right field. This ball goes back, way back. It'll be off the top of the wall on a bounce. Brown rounds first, scoring from third is Matt Bouchard. And then Brown is into second with an RBI double. Newport Gulls lead it 1-0. Brown laced that one. It was a rocket off the bat. Hit off the 25-foot marker on that 26-foot fence out there and right just installed in the offseason. The Gulls have three straight hits, their first run of the ball game, and have runners at second and third with nobody out.
Yeah, it looked like a hanging breaking ball right there from Calzone, and Brown was all over that. That one was just missed a home run by a few feet, and Keeney played it off the wall pretty well as it only got one run in for Newport, but nonetheless, Calzone's got to watch that pitch selection right there. That was just a hanging breaking ball. That Brown was just missed a home run, as you said, by a few feet.
Jim Murphy, cleanup hitter for the Gulls, the bat here. Murphy has three home runs on the season, leads the team in average, batting .349, and leads in RBIs with 11. A big cut in the first pitch, an off-speed breaking ball, missing on the outside corner, a strike, but he swung anyway. Nothing in one on Murphy. Brown at second, Miller at third. Nobody out still here in the first. 1-0 on a score, the Gulls lead it. The 0-1 outside, ball one. Murphy wasn't chasing.
Brown, Murphy in Dominguez all tied with three home runs apiece to lead the Gulls and the league.
Next closest people have two. There's about 10 guys with two home runs right now as the pitch is missing inside. Ball two. I haven't seen one break away from that three home run mark at this point. We are about 2 weeks into this season. Perhaps a little bit more, actually, as I go back in time.
Players still trying to get used to that wood bat, too, after playing with aluminum for 40-some-odd games in college.
Calzone sets and deals. Swing and a miss, strike two. Matter of fact, as I go back in time, I realize that tonight is the 2-week anniversary of this season. 2 weeks ago, it opened up here at Cardines Field with the first game of the season against the Pittsfield Dukes, a game which the Newport Gulls won 2-1 in 10 innings off of Scott Brown's walk-off home run.
That was an anniversary to remember.
Certainly was. 2-1 in scoring position, no one out. The 2-2 coming now. Swinging a high fly ball to right. This one will be popped up. He got under it and it'll fall foul and to the right out of play.
There's not much room in foul territory there. About 20 feet off the first baseline. Behind the plate, about 15 feet. And another 20 feet on the third baseline. So not that much room to make any plays.
Very odd dimensions here at Cardines Field, built in early 1900s. The 2-2 delivery coming from Calzone. Swing and a line shot in right field. This ball will forever hit. It'll score two runs. The Newport Gulls take the lead. 3-1 as the throw coming in is cut off at second. And in there with the double is Jim Murphy. 3-0 Newport. Murphy laced a 2-RBI double down the right field line. And it was recovered too late out there by Keeney to make any difference.
Yeah, that Keeney was playing over there in right field. He's playing more towards center, and that ball was just perfectly placed by Murphy to get two runs in here. Still nobody out here in the first as Dominguez comes up here. We're gonna see. Looks like we're gonna get some action early here in the bullpen for Danbury as pitching coach Kevin Long comes out for Danbury. And as we mentioned early, the bullpen's a little bit stretched here for Danbury. The only pitchers that I can think of that would be warming up is Tyler Bishop and Uchon E. As the bullpen, as we mentioned, has been struggling as of late, and they've been used very much so over the past few games.
I have to imagine with Danbury being shut out for the first time this season, their last game, that didn't help the bullpen either with pitchers going out there without any run support.
That's exactly right, and you made a good point there, Nick, as Tom Davis went out and gave up, I believe it was four runs, but only one of them was earned, and the defense hasn't been helping much of late either for Danbury. As we mentioned, the 19 errors on the season.
Four straight hits for the Newport Gulls here, a single and a single by Bouchard and Miller, an RBI double by Brown, and a 2-RBI double by Jim Murphy. Chris Dominguez to bat now. Has three home runs on the season. As we mentioned earlier, the pitch is swung on a miss. He is swinging for the fences there. Dominguez, despite the power, does lead the league in strikeouts. Chris on the season has struck out 17 times. The 0-1 in the dirt, ball one. At second, Jim Murphy. Murphy's 0 for 1 in stolen bases on the season. The Gulls don't really steal all that much, not really a good team at running around the bases. They rely primarily on power and timely hitting, something that was lacking the first week and a half of the season. They've just begun to pick up on that lately. The 1-1. Swing and a miss, strike two. A big cut there from Dominguez again, who chased a breaking ball outside.
Looks like Bishop's already warming up in the bullpen too for Danbury, so it might be a short leash for Luke Calzone tonight if he gets in a lot of trouble.
Dominguez had two errors last night and finds himself as the DH tonight. Maybe something can change here, shaking up the lineup.
A lot of lineup changes tonight in Coombs' lineup. The 1-2 is outside. Ball to the count even on Dominguez. It's the first time I've seen him in the DH spot. He's played a third consistently this season, though. Does have a relatively high number of errors for a third baseman. Dominguez with five errors on this young season. Second on the team behind Matt Bouchard, the shortstop. The 2-2. Strike three called on the inside corner. There's the first out of the inning. Finally recorded as Dominguez strikes out for the 18th time this season. He's in need of a little bit more patience at the plate, perhaps.
A much-needed strikeout right there for Luke Calzone as outside corners. He was trying to hit that all night. Finally gets the call. And so one out here, but still not out of trouble yet as the Newport Gulls offense, top to bottom, is just an electric offensive group.
Andy Lentz has done well offensively this season after joining the team late. He takes the first pitch, a fastball.
Lentz
and that
is
hits him. The pitch hit him. It graced the inside of his uniform, and that's the second hit batter of this game, the first of the inning. Of course, the shirt
Yeah, that was kind of a delayed call from the umpire on the hit batsman right there, as Lentz looked back at him after the pitch and asked if it hit him, and after a, kind of a wait there from the umpire, he said he did send him down to first base.
As you remember, the shirt hit Keeney earlier, and now Lentz here, I'm sure there's nothing doing about that. It just barely graced the inside of his uniform. And we'll see Brian Mitchell. Runners at first and second, a double play could be in order here for the Westerners. The pitch is swung on, hit high in the air to left field. The left fielder under it now charging in as the wind picks it up, and he hauls it in for out number two.
The dimensions here, Cardines, are pretty unique. In right field, you have 280 down to the right field line. Out to center field, you have 390 in deep center. And in shortened center, where there is a light post and a little jag in the fence, you have a distance of 320 feet. And then down the left field line straight, you have 330 feet. All kinds of caroms can happen out here at Cardines Field.
Yeah, you've got those odd corners out there, the corners and straightaway center up towards the triangle. And what juts out in the right center as well. This field famous for making outfielders play the caroms off the walls. Swing and a miss there from Jet Ruiz, who swings on the first pitch.
Yeah, that's the breaking ball that's been smashed the past few pitches for Calzone, but nice pitch selection right there. Kevin Long, the pitching coach for Danbury, stresses pitch selection in certain counts, and right there, that's obviously a good pitch right there for Calzone. Let's see if he comes back with something a little bit harder or outside.
He sets and fires in. That one's outside. Looked like a slower fastball there from Calzone. And the count will be 1-1. Here's an oxymoron, a slower fastball. Two on, two out. The Gulls lead it 3-0 here on four straight hits. However, after along with the hit batter, the last two have been set down. Dominguez and Mitchell. Andy Lentz stands in that first, so his hit is that one's fouled up, back and out of play. Jet Ruiz, 1-2 now, the count on him. And the Westerners are one strike away from getting out of this one. Looking in for the sign, Calzone. He has it, checks the runner. His 1-2 pitch, ball to outside.
Ruiz has one hit and 15 plate appearances, but he does have a RBI in that. In four appearances.
Brad Pippen goes over the signs with his pitcher. Now he's ready. The 2-2. Skips in the dirt in front of Pippen, and it'll be appeal to the base umpire, and he did not go.
Pippa's been getting a lot more action behind the plate as Frank Pessinello, the other catcher, was getting some more time earlier in the season, but Pippa's really shown to be a leader on the field in back-to-back nights where he's been catching.
First and second, the runners lead, 3-2 the count, the payoff pitch. Ball four upside, up and away, and the bases are loaded up for the number nine man, Brian Arcadia. We haven't seen Arcadia yet this season. He's the starting shortstop tonight for the Newport Gulls, so no stats to report for him beyond the collegiate level. Arcadia, out of Villanova University, hails from New Jersey. He'll be batting here, his first opportunity in a Gulls uniform with the bases loaded, and he is eager, stands in the pitch. Swing and a miss, strike one. You can tell that eagerness there, swinging at the first pitch, an off-speed one, which came up and away, and he missed it entirely.
Calzone's been able to get that first pitch with a lot of the Newport hitters swinging and missing, and it's just been after the first pitch that he's really been struggling.
The base is jammed, the 0-1 is on the inside corner, strike two.
Look like another off-speed pitch right there from Calzone on the inside part of the plate, and let's see what it does here with the 0-2 count. Danbury can't afford to get down here any more than they are right now.
Luke Calzone sets and pitches. Swing and a miss, strike three, a second strikeout of the inning. The Gulls leave them loaded, but not before they get three runs off the RBI doubles by Scott Brown and Jim Murphy. Newport Colts lead it 3-0 after one complete. We go to the second here on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Back here once again at Cardine's Field as we go to the top of the second. It'll be the number 4, 5, and 6 men due up for the Westerners here. Mahoney, Pesanello, and McCaslin. As they will try to swing their bats against John DeShirt. In his second start in a Newport Gullies uniform, his third overall appearance is still yet to give up a run in this season.
From the University of Maryland, was the only freshman at Maryland this year to actually see action. He was 3-3 with the Terps.
Ryan Mahoney stands in from the left side against the lefty, swings in the first pitch and sends it foul down the left field line.
Mahoney leads the team in hitting for Danbury at 286 and 8 hits, 3 doubles, 2 RBIs on the season, and Danbury as a whole only hitting 237.
Nothing in one, the count on him. John DeShirt will get the signs from Jet Ruiz, who's in for Malacone tonight. From the stretch, the pitch. Swing and a little flare into, right to the shortstop, and Arcadia has it for the inning's first out. That's the first ball we've seen hit to Ryan Arcadia, who again is eligible as of today, as of midnight tonight, midnight last night. Yeah, he couldn't have played in the game yesterday, and he can't play today, let's put it that way. If they were playing at 1 o'clock this morning, he could have played. But in that long game up in Torrington last night, the Gulls lost 6-4. That one swung on and foul tipped around the plate area to Frank Pesanello. Pesanello designated hitter tonight for the Danbury Westerners.
Yeah, not catching tonight, as we mentioned. Brad Pippa is catching. Pesanello had a night off last night in North Adams.
The pitch, swinging a foul to the screen, chicks up our backstop camera, which, as you can see, thanks to the hard work of our TV crew members here tonight, Tom Lima, Ryan Betancourt, and Ryan Phoenix, that backstop camera is in a perfect location if you're watching live right now on Team Line or on Newport County Television. From the stretch, the pitch. Up and away, ball one. 1-2 now the count on Pesanello.
And coach in third base tonight for the Danbury Westerners is Andy Wills out of Indian River Community College. And Paul Fisher is coaching in first place, in for Rob DeToma.
1-2 is lined down the left field line. It is a fair ball, and into second with a double will be Pesanello. The Danbury Westerners have their first hit of the ball game. There goes a no-hitter for John DeShirt.
A nice piece of hitting by Pesanello. Took that pitch and pulled that one, it looked like, down the left field side as that one went all the way to the fence into foul territory and getting the stand-up double. And now runner in scoring position, and see if Danbury can do something here. As we mentioned, I've been struggling. They've left a total of 90 men on base during the season.
That ball not hit on a straight line. It is fair about 40 or 60 feet down the line past third. From the stretch to the belt, and that one's laced down the right field line, foul. So the double by Pesanello did roll into foul territory after landing fair, but didn't roll far enough to get into the bullpen for a ground rule double, and had to be recovered out there by Andy Lentz, who's playing left field for the first time in a Gulls uniform. From the low set, John DeShirt's pitch. He squared for a bunt. It's taken for a strike. Not going on that one was Pesanello from second.
And as we mentioned before, Paul Fisher is coaching first, as the regular first base coach, Rob DeToma, is actually back in New York getting his master's degree in physical education. So congratulations, Rob.
Nothing in two. They count on Chris McCalzen. The pitch. Inside. Ball one. Appeal to the base umpire, John Wilkins. He didn't go around. A little bit of a check swing there from McCaslin.
McCaslin's from Moorhead State out of Ohio. Very gritty second baseman. Real leader on this Danbury squad.
John comes to the belt. His 1-2 delivery. Outside, ball two. defense for the Newport Gulls. It's a different lineup than we've ever seen here. Jim Murphy is in the normal spot at first base, and that's about it. Scott Brown is back in center after a couple nights in right. Once again, a 2-2. Skips in the dirt away from Ruiz. No chance for the run to advance. He recovers it quickly. So Murphy at first, Matt Bouchard at second, Ryan Arcadia, the shortstop, Jeff Miller, the third baseman. John DeShirt is pitching, Jet Ruiz catching him. In the outfield, left to right, Andy Lentz is in his first start in left. Scott Brown in center. Brian Mitchell moves from left to right for the first time. A radically different defensive alignment for the Gulls, who lost tonight in a little bit of a sloppy game, as Mike Coombs told us in our pregame show, 4-6. Torrington Twisters defeated them. 3-2 the count, the payoff pitch. Swing, a shot into right, charging on his Mitchell. He slides and comes up with it. A good sliding catch from Mitchell. That's the second out of the inning.
Nice job by Mitchell right there in right field. Had a come on hard as that one was hit shallow. Looked like Bouchard was coming in too on it. They didn't want to climb, but Mitchell made a late little slide at the end there for the second out. And once again, Danbury's unable to move that runner. And let's see if Brad Pippa can do it.
A slide and a roll, and he came up well.
The wind's blowing in from home plate this evening. That was a difficult catch and tough ball to read coming into short right field like that, especially with the sun setting tonight over the third base side.
That south-southwest wind blowing off the water about a block away here from Cardines Field, as I've mentioned in just about every home game. We are a block away from the water, scenic downtown Newport. A beautiful day for baseball as the stands continue to fill in here. We're here in the second. The Gulls lead it 3-0. A runner at second for the Westerners here. Two outs. The pitch is outside, ball one to Brad Pippa.
Pippa from Danbury, Connecticut. Has been mostly the catcher here for the Westerners.
This one is lined to right and on a roll by the second baseman, who throws it away. Scoring all the way from second is Frank Pesanoa. Pepper was swinging in the first pitch, hit a ground ball chopper. The second baseman, Matt Bouchard, who isn't used to playing second, again, he's an almost shortstop for the Newport Gulls, played it on a shortstop roll and tossed it way too far off the bag at first. He threw it from his back, and poor Jim Murphy had no chance to get it.
He looked a little disoriented on that play. After the roll, he was a little, I think the runner was already on first.
Well, there's going to be an error charge in the play, as that run would not have scored from second. The next pitch is popped up, back and out of play. Dan Biedenhahn, the batter now. So Pippa, would you credit him with a single? And then an RBI, and then maybe an error on the throw, perhaps?
I don't know. We'll have to double check during the break. But nonetheless, a good effort by Bouchard. But after he rolled, he probably could have set himself before after he threw it. He still had some time there, but ended up throwing away. And now the run is 3-1.
The 0-1 is missing outside, ball one. So the Westerners climbing into this one. 3-1 the count. I think the debate goes on over in the official scorer's booth. Alex McLeod, the scorer for this game. They're still discussing it over there. John DeShirt comes to the set and worries about a runner at second, the 1-1. Swinging a foul off the screen.
Could be a single in an E4 as Ryan Restivo over here from the Danbury Westerners, who's the scorekeeper down in Danbury. He said that might be what it be, but it doesn't matter. It's all the official scorekeeper. As single in E4 is my best guess.
I'm going to agree with you, Brett. That's what I think the call should be.
Dan Biedenhahn behind the count, 1-2. Two outs, a runner at second. The pitch, swing and a ground ball roller at the left field, a base hit. Being waved home is, and it tagged out at the plate. Tagged out at the plate is Pippa. He tried to score from second. He was waved around by the third base coach, and he was tagged out of the plate. And after a throw there, as Jet Ruiz blocks the plate, applies the tag, and that will do it. They do not score another run. I thought that would be run number two for the Westerners, but he did not get the run, obviously, as he's tagged out at home.
Yeah, it was a delayed wave by Andy Wells as Pippa kind of held up around third base, and Andy Wells gave a late call, and Danbury unable to score with an opportunity, but they do get one.
So they get one, and trail the ball game 3-1 after 1.5 complete here at Cardinals Field as we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Western background music here. We don't normally go with the good, the bad, and the ugly soundtrack here, but the Danbury Westerners here at Cardinals Field tonight. Yes, some new bumper intro music here as we go to the home half of the second inning. The Newport Gulls with the lead 3-1. Luke Calzone out there for another inning of work. His first pitch is on the inside corner. A called strike to the leadoff batter, Matt Bouchard. Nine men came to the plate for the Gulls back in the first. Four hits, a pair of strikeouts, a hit batter, and a walk, and 3 runs later, the Gulls now lead it 3-1. Nothing in the one, the count on Bouchard, the next pitch. It looked like a pretty good breaking ball, but it's missing inside, ball one.
Let's see how Luke does now with now he knows he can get the run support, but let's see how he reacts here after a rough first start.
1-1, the pitch, swing, a high fly ball to right. The right fielder will, on the run, make the catch at the wall. And Bouchard is retired for the first time tonight.
Nice job by Brian Keeney to run down that ball right near that, where that corner kind of tucks into right center field. Made a nice grab. I thought it got by him and bounced in, but Brian Keeney is a special kind of right fielder as he's made a lot of good grabs out in right field. Saved a lot of runs earlier this week, but made a nice grab to run down and most importantly get that first out, which that didn't happen for Luke Calzone until probably about the fifth hitter.
A very good play made on the run by Keeney. Jeff Miller singled his last time. Miller, I believe now in his fourth game in the Gulls uniform in this 2006 season, back from the 2005 season, takes the first pitch outside on the outside corner, a called strike.
Going back to that runner being thrown out, which was Pippa on the Biedenhorn line, on the Biedenhorn hit, as well after this pitch.
It's low, ball one.
You know, that's another instance where that's happened back in North Adams. We saw that a few times where Coach Wells has waved the runners around and either the runners have kind of stopped and hesitated or he just gave a late call.
The 1-1 is inside, ball two. The Westerners in the gray uniforms here tonight. Is that a t-shirt?
It's the batting practice jerseys up until we get the new uniforms coming up soon.
I was wondering. The next delivery is on the ground. Shortstop dives, can't get it. Goes in the left field, a base hit. And Jeff Miller is 2-for-2 here.
Nice diving effort by Mo Rivera. Had a range to his left, to his right, and couldn't come up with it. It was just close. It looked like it kind of went under his arm and wasn't even close to the glove. Kind of misjudged that, but nonetheless, the second hit for Jeff Miller with the runner on here with one out.
Jeff Miller came to the game tonight batting 308 with four hits, including a double. Now has six hits on the season. Scott Brown had an RBI double his last time. He's definitely broken out of the slump he was in, a 2-for-30 slump, which ended a couple of nights ago with his pair of homers against the Vermont Mountaineers here at Cardines. A check back on Miller at first, once again from Calzone.
Kind of going over the scores from last night's game. North Adams beat up on Danbury, as we mentioned earlier, 5-0. Lowell, 8-5 winner over Holyoke. Vermont, 9-3 winner over Sanford.
Waiting in the first pitch to Brown. From the set, here it comes, swinging a foul tip off the catcher's mitt.
Keene beat up on Concord in the Battle of New Hampshire, 9-1. Manchester, 11. Pittsfield, 8. And Torrington beat Newport last night, 6-4.
That was the Newport Gulls' third loss on the road this season. They are fairly well beyond that on the road. They are 4-3 away from Cardines Field. The 0-1 inside, ball one. Newport has a 3-2 record at home. Both losses coming back-to-back last week against the Sanford Maiders and the team to be named later as my memory falters. Maybe Tim can work on that one. The 1-1. Outside corner, called strike, a throw back to first, and diving in is Miller. It'll be a 1-2 count now on Scott Brown. That pitch was clipped the outside corner, and reacting quickly was Brad Pippa.
Pippa likes to throw down to first a lot, and we're going to see that a few times, seeing if he can catch the Newport runners off balance here.
Calzone sets and throws into first. again, Bouchard is, or rather Miller back sitting. Jeff Miller is not really a huge base stealing threat. Last season for the Gulls, I don't remember the stat offhand, but he didn't steal all that often.
Runners are 3 for 3 off Calzone when stealing.
1-2, the count on Brown. The pitch. Swing and a miss. Strike three. Chased a fastball up and away. That's the third strikeout for Calzone and Brown fans.
Nice job by Calzone. Kept going outside, low and outside, low and outside. Then comes right back up. High fastball and gets Brown to chase it. And that's going to be the key for Luke tonight. It's been a while since he's pitched. So it's going to have to get into a groove and get into a rhythm, and Pippa's going to have a nice call right there to get a high fastball.
He had a shaky first, giving up the 4 straight hits, the hit batter on the walk, but he's retired 2 of the last 3 here in the second. Jim Murphy had an RBI, 2 RBI doubles last time, takes the first pitch outside, another throw from first, 2 first from Brad Pippa, the catcher, and again diving in is Miller.
And let's look at tonight's games. Pittsfield's at Lowell, these games are already underway, Vermont at Sanford. North Adams is at Keene, and Torrington's at Manchester, and Concord is at Holyoke.
The Lowell and Sanford games starting at 6:30. We're at 7:20 now on the East Coast as the pitch is missing inside. Ball two.
You look at these at the standings already, Nick, here in the Southern Division. North Adams already up 9-2. I already know it's early to look at it, but a very impressive 9-2 record, especially with a very packed Southern Division.
They're off to one of the best starts in any CBL history, I believe. Not the best start, but one of the best. The runner goes. Here's the throw, and the second will not be made because not covering in time was McCalzen. And that's the first stolen base for Jeff Miller. So after all those checks and all those times I said, it's not really somebody to worry about. There he goes and steals a base.
Miller's first steal of the season on his first attempt. And Nick, the Gulls are 4-3 on the road and 3-2 at home.
4-3. I added it up right. There we go. Trying to remember back to earlier.
You gotta have some confidence in yourself.
I don't have that much. The pitch is missing outside. Ball three to Jim Murphy.
Actually, I think they're gonna call that one a strike. Oh, it was a delayed strike.
It was a delayed strike call from the home plate umpire. So hitters count now 3-1 on Murphy. But again, leads the team in batting average at 349. His average is up a couple notches. Miller with a good lead at second. The pitch. Outside, ball four. Second walk issued by Calzone. And we'll see Chris Dominguez again. Dominguez struck out looking his last time.
But I'm sorry about that. I was just going to say, though, when going back to talking about North Adams, the funny thing that comes to mind with that team is they only have one substitute on the team, one bench player, which is their catcher. So you have to figure down the stretch towards the playoff race if they're going to come tired or...
They've also committed a lot of errors, too, a lot of errors around that infield, yet their offense is so powerful, they get right back into the games. And the Newport Gulls barely got by them. Away at North Adams, the pitch is missing high, and now I remember the team that beat us, North Adams Steeplecats, here at Cardines Field, right after the Mainers came into town. And those are the only two Gulls losses at home. 1-0 here on Chris Dominguez, who will try to be a little more patient at the plate here. Striking out his last time. The pitch is swung on and missed. A big cut there.
Nice off-speed breaking ball kind of thing. Kind of can't tell right there, but you can definitely tell Calzone took something off it. And, he's been able to fool the hitters on a few pitches, but it's usually that one pitch where he's just thrown right down the middle that the Newport Gulls have been able to crush and getting some runs off.
Two on, two out. The Gulls lead it 3-1 here in the second. The pitch, swing and a miss. Strike two. Dominguez in danger of striking out for the 19th time this season.
You can definitely tell Dominguez has that home run type swing, that he just wants to jack one out every time he gets up there. And we've seen that from the last at bat in the first, and just those past two swings, you can tell right there too. He's got the power, why not?
Dominguez frequently sends him out of the park consecutively in batting practice. Low 1-2 delivery, swing and a miss, strike three. Second strikeout of the game for Dominguez, and fourth overall for Luke Calzone. The goal, strand two, they've left five. After two complete here at Cardines Field, the goal is three, the Western is one, here on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Dr. Richard Frank, the official. Some more good, the bad, the ugly bumper music here as we go to the third inning. Staying with that Westerner theme here in this ball game. Is the pitch. It's missing outside to the leadoff batter here. Dan Biedenhahn. Biedenhahn at the plate. Back in the second, the pitch is outside. Ball two from John DeShure.
Yeah, Biedenhahn being moved down the batting order has been having a little trouble with the bat as of late.
The next delivery is lined into right field, a base hit. Brian Mitchell will take it on a hop, and Biedenhahn in at first with a leadoff single here in the third.
A nice piece of hitting from Biedenhahn. Just took one pitch trying to get a look at DeShure. Then the next pitch he sees drills it into right field, a short right field hit right there. So we go back to the top of the order. Mo Rivera here for the, actually for Mo Rivera.
Here we are, 55 minutes into the game, and we've only played two complete innings, so we could be in for a long night, gentlemen.
My suspicion was right. Dan Biedenhahn did have the hit, actually. He wasn't left at the plate because he had the hit, which the runner was thrown out at the plate. A bunt here from Mo Rivera, and they will get him at first, but advancing to second is Randy Ray, who had the single.
So you were right. I had forgotten about the out in that last play.
So Biedenhahn, we'll did he have a single or a double earlier?
I believe that was a single.
A single. So that's the third hit now, given up by John DeShure. Two back in the first, a double and a single. So the Westerners have one, now three hits of the night, one batter left on base as we catch up on our scorecards and correct all of our errors. So Dan Biedenhahn did finish the second. Randy Ray led off this inning with a single, and now Mo Rivera grounds out as this is a broken bat. Foul ball around the plate area. Big cut there from Brian Kenny.
Kenny was hit by a pitch last time out and then was thrown out on a stolen base attempt out in the first. And Brian was very surprised that they were sent Brian out there to steal as trying to get his numbers here. That was his first stolen base attempt of the season. And he's been struggling with the bat as of lately, only hitting 174. In eight appearances.
A packed house here at Cardine's Field. As the fans still come in, this may be our first game of the season where we will crack, say that 10 times fast, the 2,000 mark.
Actually, check that. That was 23 at-bats for Keeney. Eight games played, I should say.
So a runner at second here. As John DeShure gets ready to throw another pitch into Brian Kenny. No balls, one strike. Kenny hit by a pitch back in the first. DeShure checks the run of the pitch. Way inside, a good stop by Jet Ruiz. One and one. Ruiz hasn't caught a game since the first week of this season. So Randy Ray led off this inning with a single. Now stands in at second, advanced on the bunt by Mo Rivera.
Looks like Mike Thader is warming in the bullpen. Might actually be just doing some light tosses, but was working in the bullpen.
The 1-1 delivery coming now. The runner goes, swinging a ground ball bouncer. The second baseman is up with it, fires the first in time, advancing to third on the play was Randy Ray. Matt Bouchard to Jim Murphy, 4-3 on the ground out, but they get the job done once again, and Ray has been advanced twice with two outs, now stands 90 feet from the plate. Tying run comes to the plate, John Delaney.
Yeah, nice piece of hitting right there by Brian Kenny. Went opposite field just to move that runner over, so there was no opportunity to throw out the lead runner at second. Randy Ray's got some good speed. He's actually, this is the first time he's been moved down the order batting ninth. He's been hitting leadoff, but the coach has been kind of a little bit upset with Randy just because he's been trying to hit a lot of home runs. He hasn't been the typical leadoff guy where he's been able to get ground balls and get on base. Randy is a big power hitter.
From the stretch to the plate, a ground ball roller. The shortstop fires the first in time, and Brian Arcadia still errorless in his first game here in the Newport Gold uniform. 6-3 on the ground out. The Westerners strand a runner at third. We've played 2.5 here at Cardine's Field. It's still Newport 3, Danbury 1, as we continue on the NEC Bell Broadcast Network. back here once again at Cardinals Field. We go to the home half of the third. Andy Lentz takes the first pitch in the dirt from Luke Calzone, who's out there for his third inning in this ball game. The Newport Gulls lead it 3-1, looking for some insurance runs here to get this one away. A long way to go this night. A cool evening here at Cardinals. Not too cool, but.
Andy Lentz from the University of Washington. Comes from a family of baseball player Huskies. His father was actually the number 2 overall pick in the 1975 draft.
Lentz from a big baseball family as he swings on that pitch. Now the 1-1 coming. Outside, ball 2. Andy Lentz is the brother of Newport Gulls 2004 reliever, and Brett, you remember this name, Richie Lentz.
That sounded familiar. I knew the Lentz name was sounding familiar.
Richie was only a sophomore and played for the Gulls in 2004. He may be coming back this year. That one is lined down the right field line. It will be foul. Ground rule to hit off the warehouse out there. That's a foul ball.
Yeah, that sounded familiar. I knew the Lentz name had a little ring to it, but nonetheless, obviously going back to that last pitch off the shack right there, if you kind of have a view, we're right behind home plate, and to your far right, to the right field, is a little warehouse where the scoreboard's mounted on, and the warehouse wall is right along that right field line, which is pretty interesting. It gives it a unique characteristic to Cardinals Field.
This interesting downtown ballpark resembling Fenway Park in some aspects. A 2-2. Breaking ball, off-speed pitch, is missing outside. So his brother Richie, probably one of the best closers in all of collegiate baseball at this point, was drafted. But the team that drafted him wants to get a look at him this summer. He had some Tommy John surgery and will be coming in perhaps later in the year. The 3-2 is hit in the air to right field deep. Way back. This ball will be a home run. Andy Lentz with a well-hit ball to right, well over the 26-foot-high fence, and he'll be greeted by his team. The Newport Gulls lead it 4-1. Lentz with a surprise home run here, his first of the season.
It looked like a hanging curveball right from Luke Calzone as Lentz just turned on it, and it kind of just hung up there from the wind as Keeney and Ray kind of looked up, and it was a home run nonetheless, and a 4-1 lead now for Newport.
Andy Lentz, who jammed his shoulder, was on the DL for a couple days, sliding into second at Danbury last week, missed a couple of games, has only played in a few. That's his first run batted in for the Gulls this year, and his first home run pitch is missing low to Brian Mitchell. So Lentz hits his first round tripper, once again gets his first RBI.
That's 340 feet out to where Lentz hit that home run.
Again, a 26-foot high fence. That fence installed over the winter. They added about 6 feet for it. It used to be a 20-foot fence from right center all the way to the foul line. The 26-foot mark remains from right center to center field. That's always been that way, although all the vines are gone that used to be on that outfield fence. The 2-0 pitch is sliced foul up the third baseline. Craig Grawl, the third base coach, ducks out of the way.
Yeah, going back to talking about Richie Lentz, I believe he was an all-star that year in 04.
Yes, he was. He was actually one of the league's top relief pitchers.
Along with former River Point reliever Cody Crowell. They had some good battles back then.
Swing and a miss. Strike 2 to Mitchell. So Lentz still waiting on word of how he's doing after that surgery a few weeks back. And they're hoping to get him in sometime in July. Just for a couple of weeks, I guess. The 2-2. Swung on a miss. Strike 3. A quick tag applied by Pippa on Brian Mitchell, and he's out for the second time tonight.
Yeah, you look back to that 04 season, and what a great team Newport had that season. And a few of them were actually drafted recently, if not last year, this year, too.
Richie Lentz drafted in the 19th round, 583rd pick overall by the Washington Nationals.
And
check that by the Boston Red Sox, actually.
Good for him, as long as he stays with the home team around here.
The Lentz family actually from Washington. The pitch, swing and a high pop-up. This one will get to the right and out of play. Over by my car, but misses it entirely, I hope.
Well, I was looking on that list. Stephen Holmes, another draftee, who also played not only with the Gulls, but played for the River Point Royals back in 04, as we go back with Gulls trivia in history.
The 0-1 to Ruiz is missing inside ball 1. Jet Ruiz walked his last time.
What
so Steve Holmes was supposed to come back to pitch for the Gulls this year, but you know he was drafted, so he signed the contract, was ineligible to play once he put the pen to the paper, 1-1. Outside corner called strike.
Well, what a great series that ended up being in the 2004 playoffs, as went down to the final at bat where Cody Crowell went to intentionally walk the hitter and got a wild pitch out of it to lose the game.
The 1-2 misses low, ball two, and of course that was unfortunately the final series for the River Point Royals, but folded after that season, but it was a way to go out.
It was a phenomenal series nonetheless. It was a great playoffs overall.
The 2-2 missing outside, ball three. And of course, the Newport Gulls went on to lose to Sanford in the championship round, 2-1. They came back in 05 and defeated the Vermont Mountaineers for their third NECBL championship and vying for a fourth this season. They'll have to get by North Adams, though, who still has a great team at this point, as ball four is outside. Jet Ruiz earns his second walk of the night.
Calzone, after really settling down in the second inning, giving up the home run, got a strikeout, and now walking the eighth hitter as Arcadia comes up to the plate. And we'll see if they still have some action going on in the Danbury bullpen, as Tyler Bishop is expected to throw tonight, as here comes manager Kevin Paxson for Danbury. Maybe he's just out to talk to Luke Calzone, or maybe he's going to give him the hook right here. We'll have to see.
We'll see if we can get a shot of our bullpen from our camera angle if you're watching on television.
Ryan Arcadia, a little bit about him I found. He is a sophomore this past year at Villanova. He's from Upper Saddle River, New Jersey. He was hitting this year 356. He had 26 stolen bases for his career at Villanova.
Give some speed for the Gulls here earlier in the season. So if he gets on base, could be a potential threat, especially going back to the top of the order with the Gulls.
Arcadia was never on the lineup. Just a recent signee by the Gulls front office to augment this infield. And we do have a new pitcher coming in, so we have a pitching change coming to you from Cardines Field with one out here in the last of the third. The Gulls leading it at 4-1. We'll be back in a moment to tell you about the new pitcher next here on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Back here once again at Cardines Field. The pitch, first pitch from Mike Thayer is down the right field line. This will be a fair ball, a base hit for Ryan Arcadia. So we just finished telling you about him, and Arcadia now has his first hit in a Newport Gulls uniform. Arcadia struck out his last time. Top of the order due up now for the Newport Gulls. And here to tell you about the new pitcher, Mike Thayer, is once again Brett Franklin.
Thank you, Nick. Mike Thayer from Holy Cross out of Worcester, is in from Worcester, Massachusetts. Mike Thayer hails from Danbury, Connecticut. He is 0-1, has a 5 ERA. This is going to be his third appearance, has two starts, 9 innings pitched, 8 hits, 5 runs all earned, 4 walks, 6 strikeouts. Opponents are hitting 229 off Thayer.
Thayer comes to the set and deals the first pitch, missing ball 1 to Matt Bouchard. So 2 pitches now issued by Thayer, the first ripped down the right field line for a single, and the Gulls have 2 on here with 1 out. Threatening to break this one open here in the third. Bouchard pops the next pitch up right side. The first baseman coming on will watch it land foul in front of him. Bouchard, 1-for-2 in the night, flew out to right in the second, single in the first. The Gulls sent 9 men to the plate in the first. 5 more to the plate in the second, and already have 5 at the plate here. In the third, as the lights come on here. In downtown Newport, as the sun sets off to the west, hopefully. A 1-1 is missing low, ball 2.
Final line on Luke Calzone goes 2 1/3, giving up 4 runs, all of them earned, 7 hits, 3 walks, and 5 strikeouts. Mike Thayer, he's usually a starter. His last outing went out against Manchester on Sunday. Did well, got the no decision, however.
The pitch, it's a fastball in the inside corner. Count even at 2-2 on Bouchard. At second for the Newport Gulls, Ryan is Jet Ruiz, who walked at first. Ryan Arcadia, who singled. Andy Lentz had a solo home run to start off this inning. Brian Missile strike out. That's how the inning is going. The pitch swinging, a high pop up. This one will go out of play over everything and right.
You know, we said that Tyler Bishop might come in to pitch, but with Mike Thader in, my only guess is that Danbury assigned a new pitcher because Thader was expected to start, I believe, Monday against Manchester with Danbury having the weekend off. So an interesting move here by Kevin Paxson to go to the starter, Mike Thader.
Bouchard battling Thader here. He takes the next pitch inside, a fastball, ball three.
And as we mentioned, Thader out of Holy Cross, plays at that beautiful field up in Worcester, home of the Worcester Tornadoes of the Independent Can-Am League. A few Holy Cross players have been playing in the NECBL.
The righty Thader sets and deals a little bloop right to the second baseman, flips his second out there on a first safe. No double play as Bouchard runs hard down the line. So it'll be a fearless choice as Arcadia is retired at second, 4-2-6.
The third baseman,
Jeff Miller, has had a night, 2-for-2 with a pair of singles. He scored a run.
Even has a stolen base to add to that.
That's correct. His first of the season.
Lights come on here at Cardine's Field, and the wind's still hanging around.
Clear skies, some very high clouds to report. That's about it. No, none of those pop-up thunderstorms we were told to expect as the pitch is inside ball one. Was expecting to see some airplanes flying around, but haven't seen any of the Rhode Island National Guard open house and air shows this weekend at Quonset Point, Rhode Island. See a shot inside the Newport Gulls dugout if you're watching on Team Line right now, our live video feed. A throwback to first, diving in is Matt Bouchard at third. Is Jet Ruiz. The Gulls have runners at the corners here with two outs. They lead it 4-1 here in the last half of the third inning. Another throwback to first, and hopping on the bag is Bouchard, who is 2-for-4 in the season in stolen bases. We did see the Thunderbirds fly by in formation a few hours ago, way well before the start time of this game, practicing for that air show this weekend. Last couple of seasons, there's been a Gulls game on the night of the SL as the pitch missing inside ball one. We've actually had our cameras point up to the skies and catch some of those planes flying by doing their acrobatics. Quite a point where the SL is, about 10 miles from here.
Always a good crowd at the SL, like tonight here at Cardine's Field. This year, I'd say averaging about 1,700 fans.
Just about that, 1,700. That average will be up a little bit tonight as we probably have almost 2,000 already at this point here in the third, and out to talk with his pitcher is Brad Pipper. So Pipper and Thader have a brief conference, and he returns back behind the plate. Runners at the corners here, 2-0 the count. On the batter, Jeff Miller.
Thader's got a good speed on his pitches tonight, just can't find the plate of late.
He comes to the set. His 2-0 pitch, instead of a fake to third, a fake to first.
An interesting note on Brad Pippa. His dad actually owns one of the sports bars in the local Danbury community. Proud sponsor of Danbury Youth Baseball.
That one is popped up in the air off the bat of Miller. Out there, the shortstop backfilling. It drops for a hit. It drops. That ball dropped out there in front of three Westerners and into second. Goes Jeff Miller on for the third time tonight, scoring from third, easily trotting home with two outs, was Jet Ruiz. The Newport Gulls lead it 5-1.
Well, don't know what happened right there, as Mo Rivera looked like he had it, and then McCaslin might have called him off, or even Randy Ray, but nonetheless, another careless mistake by the Westers. Won't be counted as an error, will be a hit. And, fielding errors have been killing the Westerners all season. It's really been an emphatic point that Kevin Paxson has made, and that should have never happened. That should have been an out and get out of the inning.
Three singles tonight for Jeff Miller as the official score of singles. It is a hit.
Heads up base running by Miller on that play. He was stuck between first and second when he realized nobody was covering second, hustled in and beat the pitcher to the bag.
So Ruiz scored from third, the Gulls lead a 5-1. The pitch, swinging a weak hit ground ball up at the first baseman will take it. Three alone for the out that retires the side. Scott Brown retired for the second straight time. But the Newport Gulls add two to their total and send seven men to the plate. Andy Lentz with the home run, and Jeff Miller's RBI single Newport Gulls lead it 5-1 as we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network.
Please direct your attention.
A reminder, this copyright telecast is the exclusive property of the Tigers TV crew and Newport Gulls, presented by the authority of the NECBL Broadcast Network, and may not be reproduced, re-recorded, or retransmitted in any form. And the accounts and descriptions of this game cannot be disseminated without the express written permission of Tigers TV, the Newport Gulls, and the Commissioner's Office of the New England Collegiate Baseball League. The Newport Gulls lead it 5-1 here at Cardinals Field. We go to the top of the fourth. Here with the play-by-play is Brett Franklin.
Thank you very much, Nick Lima. As we head to the top of the fourth, it'll be Ryan Mahoney, Frank Pesanello, and Chris McCaslin leading it off for the Westerners. Mahoney is 0-1. He flew out to the, popped up to the shortstop, actually. In the it was a shallow hit to shortstop. It'll be Frank Pesanello following, and then, as we mentioned, Chris McCaslin, the second baseman. 5-1 Newport as we head here to the top of the fourth. John DeSure going on for another inning of work. The left-hander gets the sign and the pitch. Hanging, breaking ball, and having to duck out of the way is Mahoney for ball one. Mahoney starting at first base tonight. The 1-0 pitch. There's a little grounder past the diving first baseman and into right field for a base hit. So the leadoff runner gets on for the Westerners for Frank Pesanello.
That's the fourth hit of the night given up by John DeShirt. And the second time tonight, second straight inning, the Westerners get their leadoff man on.
So Frank Pesanello, the designated hitter, comes up, had a double back in the second inning and scored the only run for the Danbury Westerners. DeShure checks the runner at second and the pitch.
DeShure has an excellent move to first. This past season at Maryland, he had four pickoffs.
That pitch was taken low for ball one. 1-0, the count to Pesanello from Plainville, Massachusetts. The 1-0 pitch. That pitch stays high for ball two. Actually, Plainville, right about 10 minutes from my hometown in Norton, Massachusetts. Home of the Division III second place finishers, the Wheaton College Lions. For all you D3 nuts out there, the 2-0. This one is popped up down the first baseline, but out of play. But the D3 playoffs always have some great games that are played out in Wisconsin. Few Eastern Connecticut State players on this Danbury roster and throughout the league, as Eastern Connecticut State, a powerhouse in Division III as well, made an appearance in the College World Series yet again. They were the 2002 Division III state champ, Division III national championship champions, I should say.
The say 2-1. That 10 times fast.
There's a check swing from Pesanello. He went around for strike two. Yeah, you're telling me. I was trying to. Got a few state champions. That's high school, and then you've got the national champions. Pesanello went to Bishop Feehan High School in Attleboro, Massachusetts. Premier athletic program out there at Bishop Feehan. The 2-2, low for ball three. Count runs full.
Two strikes, ladies and gentlemen.
Pesanello with a double earlier tonight. He hit that ball well to left field earlier tonight.
Really pulled that one down that left field line. So nobody out, one on. Mahoney at first, Pesanello at the plate. Here's the payoff pitch from DeSure. This one is popped up into shallow right field. Mitzer coming on and will make the grab, as Mitzel, I should say, for the first out. So one out recorded, and here's the second baseman, Chris McCaslin.
You're seeing that the wind could be playing some tricks with those pop-ups tonight. A lot of people, you know, calling it is becoming very important. Call that ball.
Especially out there in deep right field, where a few balls actually might have been carried a little bit farther than they would have if there was no wind out there. So good point. So here's McCaslin, and he's takes a ball outside, 1-0. McCaslin lined out to the right fielder his last time up in the second inning. 5-1 Newport here in the top of the fourth. John DeSure pitched very well. I mean, the Westerners have gotten a few hits off him here and there, but the defense has really done well for Newport. Here's the pitch. Outside for ball two. 2-0. Good sized crowd here at Cardinals Field. Always a good crowd.
Well, this may be the goodest of the season.
That pitch is taken high, and it's now 3-0.
That was intentional, by the way.
The goodest. Newport Daily News Little League night tonight. A lot of kids wearing the uniforms, somewhat resembling the World Cup fans with the colors on tonight.
That pitch is high, so four straight pitches equals into a walk, and now two on with one out for Brad Pippa.
Speaking of the World Cup, a lot of sports action going on right now, including locally. You've got the CBS Charity Golf Classic happening. You've got the U.S. Women's Open here in Newport. And Scott Vergilak will come out to have a word with the shirt here. Vergilak, pitching coach at Rhode Island College.
Was the manager last year for the North Adams Steeplecats. They got a new manager this year in Laz Gutierrez. So Brad Pippa is up here in the second. He singled and then reached second on an error. It was a single and an error. Charged to Bouchard back in the second. And then he was thrown out at home plate trying to score on the Dan Biedenharn single. So Pippa comes to the plate with a chance to cut this 5-1 Newport lead down.
Westerners maybe looking for their second home run of the season here.
That would be nice. I'm sure Kevin Paxton would love that too. So here's the shirt. Checks the runner at second and the pitch. That catches the outside corner for strike one.
Desher, twice the Delaware State baseball player, 2004-2005, only losing two games in high school.
The 0-1 pitch. Hanging curveball, check swing, foul to the backstop. It's 0-2.
The scouts say he has an excellent breaking ball and a great move to first. Haven't seen that good move to first yet tonight, though.
Well, hasn't had really many runners on. Actually, check that. They've had a runner on. The Westerners have had a runner on each inning. Just haven't been able to score, get them across. The 0-2 pitch. Fouled off yet again, and we'll do it again.
You got to imagine if the scouting report says it's a great pickoff move, but it's got to be something noticeable, something different than the norm. You know, some sort of cartwheel and a... Well, maybe not that dramatic, but something outstanding and out of the ordinary. I haven't noticed it. If he has used it this season.
The left-hander sets the 0-2 pitch. Taken for a called strike three for the second out of the inning. Down goes Pippa.
That's the second strikeout for the shirt. The first batter of fan looking.
All right, hey, Robin, who is that t-shirt courtesy of?
So this will bring up Dan Biedenharn. He's 1-for-1, singled back in the second.
Now six strikeouts on the season for John.
Biedenharn, as we mentioned, has been moved down in the lineup as of lately. He usually bats around the top three of the order. But Kevin Paxton mixing up the lineup here. Here's the pitch. A little grounder over to Bouchard at second. He'll take the easy out, throws to first, and he'll end the top half of the fourth. Westerners strand two, and after 3.5, it's 5-1 Newport on the NECBL Broadcast Network. And we're back here in the bottom of the fourth as the Newport Gulls have a 5-1 lead on the Danbury Westerners. It will be Jim Murphy, Chris Dominguez, and Andy Lentz to lead it off here for the Newport Gulls as Mike Thader delivers the first pitch back to Thader on the mound. He'll underhand it to first for the first out of the inning. That'll bring up Chris Dominguez. First one pitch, one out, and Dominguez is 0-for-2 with two strikeouts. We're here in the bottom of the fourth. It is 8:01 on the East Coast. I'm Brett Franklin alongside Nick Lima and Tim Wine bringing you all the action here. Beautiful night here at Cardines Field.
No ominous clouds to report as of yet. There is a chance of some isolated thunderstorms in the Rhode Island area tonight.
And that pitch was inside for ball one. As the sun sets here in Newport, that pitch is high and tight and went around as Dominguez for strike one. Would have been ball two if he had hung on to that bat. Hung on to that swing, I should say. Didn't let that bat go. The 1-1 pitch from Thayer. Hanging breaking ball popped up into left field. Delaney under it and will make the out for the second out of the inning.
It's a high pop-up, but the wind carried that ball a little bit further out to left than I thought it would go.
And that'll bring up Andy Lentz. Had a solo home run back in the third and was hit by a pitch back in the first. So Lentz steps the plate. Mike Thayer will face him for the first time tonight and the pitch. That hits the dirt before the plate, and it's 1-0.
Talk about those Newport goals that were drafted a couple weeks ago in the Major League Baseball amateur draft. In the third round, 87th pick overall, Kyle Hankard.
As that one is grounded to Mo Rivera, ranges to his right, makes the nice throw for the first 1-2-3 inning. And just talking about the draft right there for a second. And also, I notice also on there, Billy Muldowney, another familiar face on the draft
list. Yeah, Muldowney, a former River Point Royal, and of course the Newport Gulls pitcher in the 2005 season as well. So we'll keep it right here and have a little talk about the draft, if you will.
Yeah, it's kind of a hidden excitement there for, if you can say, if you follow it on MLB.com, does a great job of following the draft, and a lot of the 2000, I believe, for the past few years, the NECBL has had more draftees than the Cape Cod League as of late.
And that is actually true. With all the teams and all the roster changes that occur in the NECBL, you see a lot of players come in and out of these teams over the course of a summer, and just a lot more opportunities, really, to be drafted.
Yeah, you see, and everyone talks about the Cape Cod League, which it is a great, great league, but the NECBL has the same amount of talent. And especially at the All-Star Game, see a lot of scouts there, especially for this year up in Keene, New Hampshire.
And going down the line of some of those other goals drafted, you had Travis Webb and Billy Muldowney, Tom King, all drafted in the eighth round. Tom King, a 2004 goal. Zach Clem, who was a power bat for the Gulls last year, drafted in the 11th round by the Milwaukee Brewers organization. You had Stephen Douglas, as well as Michael Afrani, a two-time Gull drafted. Afrani was drafted by the Oakland Athletics, Afrani out of Lemoyne College. Going right down that line, Richie Lentz, of course, his brother Andy on the team, and Richie might be joining the team later, as we mentioned earlier. He was drafted by the Boston Red Sox. Ben Frensgraf, Brooks Dunn, and Sean McGill. McGill, another two-time goal, also played with Manchester for a brief period of time. He was drafted by the Philadelphia Phillies and in the 23rd round of the draft. And going right down, Mike Chambers, a 2004 goal, was drafted as well. Tim Langham, who was signed by the Gulls but never actually played in a game, was drafted in the first round, the 10th pick overall. Drafted by San Francisco as a right-handed pitcher by that team. And some interesting conversation about the draft.
Always good to talk about the draft. And so many future talent coming out of the draft, obviously. So here's Randy Ray to lead it off. Takes an inside pitch for a called strike. Ray singled his last time up in the third. Here as we head to the top of the fifth, 5-1 Newport. As John Deshier, the left-hander, delivers high for ball one. So the first 1-2-3 inning for the Westerners at the bottom of the fourth. Here's the 1-1. There's a bunt attempt by Ray and kept the bat out for called strike two. The One ball, two strikes to Randy Ray out of Eastern Connecticut State University. The local from Danbury, Connecticut in his second year with the Westerners. Here's the 1-2. This one is pulled down the line, foul down the third baseline.
Brett, the Westerners as a team are hitting .237. That's good for seventh in the NECBL.
Well, I figured it might have been a little bit lower, just because the snag that the Westerners have had lately with the hitting. And the Westerner coaches have been emphasizing that all season. The 1-2 pitch. There's a little slow roller over to Arcadia at shortstop. He makes the quick throw to first, and it's not in time. Randy Ray hustling down the line and gets an infield hit.
Arcadia fielded that cleanly. Just didn't put enough on that throw, and it was beat out.
It looked like he kind of waited on that ball to get to him. So nonetheless, we head to the top of the order with Mo Rivera. He's 0 for 2, grounded to third base in the first, and bunted on in the third to move the runner over, but to no avail, didn't help out the Westerners. Quick snap over to the first, and having to jump up really high was Murphy.
Maybe that was that good move they were talking about. You make the first baseman jump, and
well, that was
lures the first base runner off the bag.
That was a quick move there from DeSure. Nice quick move. Didn't really move the leg, and there's a pitch outside in the dirt for ball one.
Getting back to the team batting, the esteem honor of last place belongs to the Lowell All-Americans, who are hitting a combined .184.
Well, that's – well, Lowell really has really been in the bottom of the league for the past 4 years, and the 1-0 is taken high and away for ball two. That's an interesting stat, 189. I mean, you know, usually you see that at, you know, maybe after the first week of play, but the All-Americans are struggling not only on the field, but in attendance as well. They have to compete with the Lowell Spinners, the North Shore Spirit, and also the Boston Red Sox. 2-0. Down the middle for a called strike.
Of course, here the Newport Gulls, they have a very good location. You got McCoy Stadium to the north, but that draws most of central Rhode Island in. You've got all these people here in Newport County just edging to go to a ball game now and then, and they have this opportunity here.
There's a quick snap over to first, not in time. Now, that's kind of, well, Lowell, with the Spinners are right across the street, and most of their home games are right when the Spinners have their games, and the North Shore Spirit are about 5 minutes away in Lynn, Massachusetts. That ball's low, and it's 3-1.
Now, I've never been to the All-Americans ballpark. How is it up there?
It's Stoskaloosa Field, I believe it, or Alumni Field. It used to be where the Lowell Spinners played, so it's not too bad. Right off 495. The 3-1, a little grounder over to Bouchard, gets it over to second, and in time. 4-6-3 double play, and we have two down here in the fifth.
That's the 10th double play turned by the Newport Gulls infield this season.
But Lowell has been struggling mightily the past 4 years. Just in general, and the whole organization as a whole, you know.
You have to wonder how much longer they can be a viable team if they really can't get it going. They do have a newly designed website this year, I noticed.
It looks like they've been trying to get a whole new look. As Brian Keeney comes to the plate and takes a called strike down the middle. They've got a whole new look, but might be the same result. They had the Papelbon brothers last year, which got them some notoriety, but haven't made the playoffs since their existence in 2000. That pitch is high for ball one.
The change in name from Mill City All-Americans to Lowell All-Americans, so I guess you could call them the Lowell Americans, formerly of Mill City.
The nickname for Lowell, as there's a check, trying to check in a swing was Keeney, and he goes around, and it's 1-2.
Maybe trying to tap onto that Lowell Spinner's name, too, with the Lowell All-Americans version.
I don't know where you can get the Spinners out of. That's kind of a...
Well, no, Lowell, not Spinners. The other Lowell team.
And that pitch is in the dirt for ball two.
Spirit?
The North Shore Spirit.
North Shore Spirit. There's a team with Lowell with the first name.
The Lowell Lockmonsters.
Lockmonsters is the
AHL team.
I'm all over the place, folks. Just ignore every word I say from now on.
The 2-2 pitch from DeSure is fouled out of play. Yeah, the Loch Monsters did pretty well, I think. I think they made the playoffs in the AHL, at the American Hockey League. A lot of sports up there. North Shore Spirits, not in Lowell. It's in nearby Lynn, Massachusetts. But it's a five-minute drive from where the All-Americans are. Two out, nobody on. Here's the 2-2 pitch. High and outside, and the count runs full on Brian Keeney. He was hit by a pitch in the first and grounded to the second baseman in the third. The Lowell Spinners are the Class A organization of the Boston Red Sox. The payoff pitch. Slow roller over to the third baseman, Miller. He grabs on a hop, throws to first in time. So after getting the lead runner on, 4-6-3 double play by Rivera and a ground out to the third baseman, Brian Keeney. Down go the Westerners after 4.5 here in Newport. It's 5-1 goals on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Of the fifth. 5-1 Newport goals over the Danbury Westerners. As it'll be Brian Mitzel, Jet Ruiz, and Ryan Arcadia for the goals here. As first pitch is drilled down the left field line, hooking foul and out of play.
Into the bullpen down in left field.
That ball was really carried and had a shot to get out of there, but hooked foul. Brian Mitzel is 0-2 with a strikeout to his name in the third inning. The 0-1 pitch from Thader. That was a curveball that didn't really curve. High and tight, had to back out of the way, was Mitzel, and it's 1-1. Mike Thader came in for Calzone early as there's a check swing and it's called for a strike. 1-2. Calzone didn't last very long. Again, his number is 2 1/3, 4 runs all earned, 7 hits, 3 walks, and 5 strikeouts. There's a line shot down the third baseline. Nice stop by Biedenhorn. Throws to first in time. Great diving stop by Dan Biedenhorn to get the first out.
And that was an effortless throw. I mean, he just gunned that and had him out by a mile.
Really took his time on the throw, too, as he said, Tim, and he... An effortless throw and gets the out. That's all you really need to do sometimes. A lot of the players like to rush the throw and like to really hurry up and make it look real snazzy, but he took his time and got the out as Jet Ruiz comes to the plate. Walked both times up here. That one is skied high. Pop up as Mahoney comes under it and will make the grab for the second out of the inning. So this will bring up Ryan Arcadia. 1-2 with a strikeout and a single back in the third. So Mike Thader, as we mentioned, is on for relief here in the fifth.
Shortstop, number six.
So,
Arcadia.
So Arcadia takes the first pitch in the dirt outside for ball one. The 1-0 pitch outside, and it's 2 balls, no strikes. Westerners trying to stay out of the basement here as they are 4-7. Pittsfield's down in the bottom at 4-8, high and tight yet again, and it's 3-0.
Arcadia is the leadoff man for the Wildcats, and he's got an on-base percentage of .407.
Villanova playing in the Big East. 3-0, taking all the way, and it's a strike, was Arcadia.
After this game here tonight, the Newport Gulls will go back on the road one more time to face the Manchester Silkworms for the first time this season.
3-1 is fouled to the backstop, and the count runs full.
That game tomorrow will be the final game of a 12 straight game stretch, going all the way back to June 12th, including a five-game road trip in the middle of that stretch, so the toughest stretch all season for Newport. We'll wrap up tomorrow.
Payoff pitch, a little grounder off the mound. It'll get into center field for a base hit. So Arcadia gets his second hit of the night. And with two out and one on, we go back to the top of the order with Matt Bouchard.
Arcadia has been a little bit of a pleasant surprise in his first night here in a Newport Gulls uniform. Pair of singles.
And Miller in his starting role has really been a nice addition to the Gulls tonight.
Of course, Miller back from the 2005 championship season.
And like Miller, I'd like to see if Arcadia could take it a free 90 feet away from him here with a steal. Let's see.
Thayer checks the runner at first. Actually, he'll go over and throw, and it's not in time. The Westerners will be in Pittsfield with a date with the Dukes tomorrow at Waconia Park. That game is set for 7 o'clock. Pitch, runner goes. Pippa throws down to second, and it gets away from the second baseman. Runner will hold at second. So give the stolen base to Arcadia. And a runner in scoring position, and a chance for Bouchard to knock another run in.
Oh, the guy's a triple threat so far.
Well, Arcadia didn't get the best jump. Pippa had him tagged out, but the throw was good. The tag just wasn't there.
It looked like it kind of took a bounce before it went into the glove of it looked like McCaslin was covering. But Pippa had the throw, as Tim mentioned. The 1-0 pitch, high and tight for ball two. But as we said, the Westerners will be in Pittsfield tomorrow. They have Sunday and Saturday off. Much needed rest. Monday they'll be home to the Manchester Silkworms, and then Tuesday they'll be back with the Manchester Silkworms at Northwest Park. 2-0 pitch. Hanging curveball fouled out of play. Danbury won the first meeting between the Silkworms 8-4 at Northwest Park. That was the game that Mike Thayer started.
That one, that foul ball rolling back into the intersection behind us on America's Cup Avenue here. Busy four-lane road.
Always interesting to see fans like the ball hit the car. That one is drilled into right field, and it's going to be a foul ball. Looks like it might have hit off the warehouse again, and the count will run 2-2. That could have been another run right in.
Newport looking for their third straight win here at home. They did win the first game against the Dukes, then drop the next two against Maine and Sanford, Maine, and the Northam Steeplecats won the last two.
I believe Danbury, they met up earlier this season too, and Danbury had the final say. I think I believe it was 6-3.
That's correct.
Thayer checks the runner at second, and the 2-2 pitch. That pitch stays high, and the count runs full.
The temperature hasn't dropped much since the start of the first pitch tonight, and continues to be a lovely evening here at Cardines Field.
Perfect night for baseball. A little bit of fog I can see in the distance now, though.
Fog always interesting here at Cardines Field, to say the least. Last Tuesday night, Danbury played into midnight in the 12th inning after the rain delay. Fog rolled in from left field and basically covered the outfield, and it looked like a scene out of Cardines Field. Payoff pitch. Runner goes. The throw from Pippa down to third. It's going to be not in time. Close play. Biedenhorn was covering over at third, and the steal to Arcadia. He was running on the 3-2 pitch, and a walk issued to Matt Bouchard.
We'll see if we can. It's a replay in the play at third.
And with that steal, Arcadia ties the team lead league with two steals. Bouchard has two as well.
So another stolen base for Arcadia here in the inning. Jeff Miller comes to the plate. He's had himself a great night. He is 3-for-3, single and scored in the first, singled and stole a base back in the second, double, had an RBI double back in the third. And there's a grounded to Biedenhorn, a diving Biedenhorn over at third base, makes the throw in time at first. Nice play by Dan Biedenhorn, another great play. And that'll do it here in the fifth. After five innings of play, the Newport Gulls 5, the Danbury Westerners 1 on the NECBL Broadcast Network.
As he has the bat of Angelberger, strike one swinging to Matt Carl, who is the now seventh hitter.
All right, here back in the top of the sixth, John Delaney will lead it off as he had some some interference there with the list live view of the North Adams game. As that pitch is high and outside for ball one, John Delaney is 0-for-2 with a strikeout back on the first.
Oh, that's our new technology here as we feed our laptop right into the live feed of our broadcast and try to get the out-of-town scores. That's the best way to do it, I can imagine.
The 1-0 swung on and missed. That's actually pretty good, actually. It was just the timing we had.
I know, you
were just doing so many things at one time. It was quite a task, to say the least.
Yeah. Just forgot to close the program coming back into our own game here.
John DeSure, the 1-1 outside.
Of course, that North Adams Keene game in Port, with North Adams leading the Southern Division, and Keene coming here to Cardines Field on Monday night for the Newport Gold's next home game.
Keene with another strong team. That team went 32-10 last year, I believe. Taken for a called strike, it's 2-2. I believe that's the best record in the NECBL by far, was the 32-10 record that the Swampbats put up last year. And go figure, they did not even make it to the NECBL championship game, which everybody thought they would. The 2-2 pitch in the dirt, and the count runs full.
If I recall, it's probably the best record in NECBL history.
I believe that's what it is.
Oh, tied, or it was either the best or tied for the best.
One of the best, I think it was. And yet again, they put up another powerful team. 3-2. This one is drilled into deep left center field. Back goes Brown at the wall. It's going to be bounced off the wall. Delaney's going to hustle in for two in time. He'll stand up for a leadoff double. So John Delaney getting into the swing of things here. Starts it off with a double here for the Westerners. So nice job by John Delaney. Took a 3-2 pitch and drilled it into left center field, I should say. And a leadoff double, and trying to get things going as Danbury trills to Newport 5-1, and Ryan Mahoney leads it off 1-for-2 with a single. DeSure checks the runner at second, and the pitch inside below the knees for ball one. DeSure, the 1-0. Curveball taken for a called strike.
We turn off our sounds of the game field mic here as some kid decided to pick it up and start playing with it down there.
They're just kids. They say the darndest things, apparently.
They make up a lot of the attendance here.
That's a low strike, and it's 1-2. Kids do make up a lot of the attendance in the NECBL. Through all the free clinics that the teams put on, it's really a great thing. The 1-2, fouled off and out of play. Wanted to thank those for listening on the Team Line broadcast network. Also viewing it on the internet. Great job by the Newport Broadcast Network here. Excellent job, guys. The 1-2 swung on and missed for a called strike three. That is going to be the third strikeout for John DeSure. And with one out and one on, Frank Pesanello comes to the plate.
Number 17, Frank Pesanello.
I should go back there and say it wasn't a called third strike. It was a swung on and missed for a third strike. That's what I meant to say. So here's Pesanello. 1-for-2, doubled and scored back in the second. First pitch swinging, fouled it off to the backstop. Here in the top of the sixth, 5-1 Newport. Over the Danbury Westerners, I'm Brett Franklin alongside Nick Lima and Tim Weiner. Fouled off and out of play. 0-2. Tim Wine, sorry about that, Tim.
Don't worry about Brett.
I don't think Tim is phased.
Tim never gets phased. He's on top of everything tonight, giving out the great additional statistics and information that all the diehard NECBL fans need.
His debut as a color man here on the NECBL.
Doing a great job.
It's an honor and privilege, gentlemen, to be here with you guys this evening.
I'm honored as well to be among this fine broadcasting company.
I'll tell you one thing. He's got the voice for a broadcasting booth. I'll tell you that for sure.
Thank you.
Maybe some PA might be in line for Tim. We don't know. Here's the 0-2. High and tight for ball one. .830 here on the East Coast. Thanks for everybody tuning in here to the game. 5-1 Newport. John Deshier checks the runner at second and the pitch. This one is drilled foul down the left field line. Pesanella, know he had a hit, just pulled it way too much.
And just so you all know, coming up in the middle of the sixth inning, we'll have a check on the out-of-town scores. The Sanford Mariners playing at the Vermont Mountaineers, a key Northern Divisional game going on right now.
1-2, the count to Frank Pesanella with the runner on second. The pitch outside. Deuces on the board here. 2-2, one out. Delaney at second after a leadoff double. And give credit to the Westerners. They've been getting the runners on. But the story yet again, cannot get the runners across. 2-2. High for ball three.
The shirt goes for the fastball there against Pesanella.
See if Deshier maybe throws a curveball right here. That's been mostly his out pitch, and they haven't been able to hit that. 3-2. Check swing, and it's going to be a called strike three. So down goes Pesanella, another strikeout for Deshier. And with two outs, back-to-back strikeouts, here's Chris McCaslin.
His pace has slowed down considerably here in the sixth inning. And again, we are at 8:30 now on the East Coast. This game has begun to slow down a little bit on both sides after moving on fairly quickly through the first five innings.
That first inning was brutal for the Westerners and obviously glorious for the Newport Gulls. Getting three runs in the first early, and Danbury putting up one in the second, and then Newport two in the third. And they haven't really had to look at Danbury very much for the threatening, as that one is high for ball one. As Danbury is just kind of laid back. They got that one run in the second, as we mentioned, off a single, it looked like, from Brad Pippa. Yet that was an RBI single for Brad, and it was an error that he reached second, too, on the same play. 1-0 pitch. This one is skied into center field. Coming on hard is Brown, and it's going to drop in for a base hit. Here comes Delaney to score, and on to second is McCaslin. He will stand up with an RBI double. So another run for Danbury, and it's 5-2 now, Newport.
Well, they're trying to inch closer here, and it's going to be timely hitting like that. That ball dropped just in front of Brown. Nobody could get to it quite in time. And the lead cut to three.
So a nice piece of hitting by McCaslin, even though I don't think he was aware that Ruiz was making a throw down to second as he was rounding first, and but nobody was covering the bag. So an RBI single, RBI double for Chris McCaslin.
The young man at our field microphone has moved on. I'll put that back on.
Second RBI for McCaslin on the year. Deshier checks the runner and the pitch. There's a grounder over to the second base. Arcadio will get it on a hop, throws to first in time. So down go the Westerners, but not without getting an RBI double from Chris McCaslin after 5.5. It's 5-2 Newport on the NECBL broadcast network. Go top bottom of the sixth as Mike Thader goes back to work. Scott Brown lines one right to Mo Rivera for the first out of the inning. One pitch, one out.
This is the meat part of the lineup for the Gulls with Brown, Murphy, and Dominguez.
And we'll go to that bullpen camera shot now.
Looks like Tyler Bishop is warming up for the Westerners, and no tossing for the Gulls as of yet.
I did see Dan Wilson run in from the bullpen before the inning began, so maybe he could be looking to come in to replace Disher.
Jim Murphy steps to the plate, takes a strike from Mike Thader, the 0-1. Breaking ball stays high, and it's 1-1. Jim Murphy had two RBI double back in the first, walked in the second inning, and grounded out to Thader back in the fourth. There's the 1-1, and it's taken for a called strike, 1-2.
I'd like to take a moment to thank our camera people tonight, Ryan Betancourt on our dugout camera, and Jackie Twist on our left field camera, doing a great job getting these shots for you.
There's a breaking ball, sliced foul, and out of play. Yeah, they've been doing a great job. Everybody's been doing a great job here tonight. So
Ryan's in the hot seat on the first base camera tonight. He's about 20 feet away from home plate on top of the Gulls dugout.
1-2 is drilled into center field. Randy Ray going back, and he'll make the grab for the second out. So two down for Chris Dominguez, 0-for-3 with two strikeouts.
Of course, that cameraman he put on top of that dugout, always protected by an L screen up there, one of the batting practice L screens that they put on top of the dugout to protect our camera and, more importantly, the camera person running it.
Thader goes to work quickly, and that pitch is outside in the dirt. The appeal over to first is no avail, and it's 1-0. Well, it's always a favorite of mine to come here to Cardines Field. The 1-0. Curveball skied into right center field. Randy Ray ranging over, and he will make the grab for the third out. 1-2-3 inning for the Danbury Westerners after six innings of play. 5-2 Newport on the NECBL broadcast network.
I'm a better hitter for the next level. Dan Ford stops.
And now for the play-by-play after that pitch taken outside is Nick Lima.
Thank you very much, Brett, as we go to the top of the seventh inning. Nothing in one, the count here to the leadoff batter in the inning, Dan Biedenhahn.
John Disher still on the mound, his longest outing of the night, of the year, excuse me. He's pitched six complete. All season, he's only pitched eight innings total.
Biedenhahn working from the stretch still, throws in, and it's missing outside an off-speed pitch. 2-1 now the count on Biedenhahn, who has, again, 1-for-2 with a single tonight, bounced a second to end the fourth inning.
Had some nice plays at third base as well.
The pitch, fastball missing up and away. 3-1 a hitter's count now on Biedenhahn. Randy Ray waits on deck, then the top of the order due up for the Westerners, who trail this ball game 5-2. Ball four is outside, and a leadoff walk issued here to Dan Biedenhahn. He's on for the second time tonight, and for the fourth time tonight, the Westerners have their leadoff man on. Jet Ruiz out for a word with the shirt.
Well, that's a good stat to have if you're a manager, getting your leadoff guy on at least four times tonight. But the question is, they haven't been able to move the runners and get more runs. I mean, if you look at the stats or your scorecard, you might have more runs. This might be a closer game than it is, as now we're going to have some more discussion out on the mound.
Mike looks like Coombs.
Looks like they're calling for a right-hander to come in from the bullpen.
And that is the case. So we do have a pitching change. So that'll do it for Desherry. He walks the first man he sees here in the seventh, and after only giving up two runs through six innings, walking the first man here in the seventh, that will do it for him. We have a pitching change coming to you in this game from Cardines Field, with the Gulls leading the game 5-2 here in the top of the seventh as we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Back in just a moment to tell you about the new pitcher. Here once again at Cardines Field, Pat McAfee will be making his fourth appearance in the Newport Gulls. May not be Pat McAfee.
I believe it's Mike Lowry, Nick, as it's 29 on the mound, not 19. As I know, it's kind of hard to see on that uniform, but
that's correct. That is in fact correct. We thought it was McAfee. We were all getting set to announce his arrival. It is 29. Mike Lurie, the new pitcher. So sorry about that, folks. Mike Lurie. And with a line on Mike Lurie on his stats this season, missed him mine.
Yep, he has. He got an ERA of 3.6. He's got two appearances. He's had two saves this year. He's pitched 10 innings, and he's given up four runs, walked four, had three strikeouts, and has given up a double and no home runs.
Actually, he hasn't had two saves. He's had two starts on the season.
I'm sorry. I apologize.
That's all right. So Lurie, and it's the first time of the first a relief appearance we've seen from him. He sends the first pitch in there, ball one, to the batter, Randy Ray, who's 2-for-2 with a pair of singles, including an infield single back in the fifth.
John Deshur, the line on him, six innings pitch. He's responsible for the runner on first. Two earned runs, seven hits, two walks, and four strikeouts, and one hits batsman.
The 0-1 is swung on and missed, strike one. So Mike Lurie is the pitcher now. We had thought it was Pat McEnany. Sorry, Pat. Your number wasn't called this time. It's Mike Lurie, the second pitcher of the night for the Newport Gulls, who replaces John Deshur. Here in the seventh, a leadoff walk was issued by Deshur. That's where we stand. Nobody out, runner at first. 1-1, the count on Randy Ray. Lurie, the righty, comes to the set, to the belt, and to the plate. Fastball on the outside corner, strike two.
Lurie, 6'7", 220. Strong right-handed pitcher.
Has walked four men on the season, giving up four earned runs, and has three strikeouts to his credit. As a check on the runner at first, back standing is Biedenhahn.
Well, a nice night for Deshur, and on the other side, might be the last we've seen of Mike Thader.
The 1-2, outside ball two. Lurie has given up one extra base hit, a double. He's also hit a batter on the season. It'll be up to him probably to close this game out as we're here in the seventh. The Gulls don't have a dedicated closer yet. And Mike Coombs hasn't really been using a bullpen by committee. He's been putting in one long reliever in there to stay in for the rest of the game until he falters. The 2-2, ground ball bounce, comeback right to Lurie. He'll fire the second out there on the first. Not in time. They can't turn the double play, but they get the lead man. And Biedenhahn is retired on with the fielder's choice, Randy Ray.
Lurie to Arcadia, those are college teammates, both Wildcats from Villanova University. Mike Combs has a couple good pitchers in the bullpen to go to. There's Mike Lynn from Louisville, and then there's Rob Wilson from Davidson that have both played very well this year.
A lot of options for Combs, who, of course, a couple of new arms have just come in, been signed recently by the front office, including Bellevue. Making his way in. He'll be pitching on Monday. His first appearance will be against the Keene Swamp Bats, and that's going to be a rough one here in Newport as ball one is outside to the leadoff batter, Mo Rivera.
Is he from the College of Charleston, I believe?
I'm not too
sure. I believe
he
is.
Possible.
Coming from the College World Series where they had a very fine effort.
The pitch, swinging a ground ball, chopper, pulled foul up a third base line, and count evens up at 1-1 on Rivera, who's 0-for-3 tonight. Advance the runner with a bunt back in the third, grounded out 5-3 in the first and bounced into a 4-6-3 double play in the fifth.
I believe that was their first appearance in the College World Series was College of Charleston. Mostly known for their basketball.
A throwback on first, a quick check on the runner, Randy Ray. He wasn't going anywhere. 1-1 the count on Mo Rivera. You folks in your college sports, I don't follow any of that. I don't have time. I wish I could. It'd help me here. These are all collegiate players vying for competition. Trying to be selected in the draft at some point as the pitch is squared for a bunt and bunted foul to the backstop. Ray was into second. He'll go back to first and we'll do it again. 1-2 should be the count here.
Ray had an excellent jump off first. He would have been in easily to second base.
Now, I was just going to say with the College World Series, you've seen a lot of great games. Some surprises. Miami was knocked out. Cal Fullerton was knocked out. Had a lot of surprises in Oregon State. Holy smokes, who saw them coming out of the Pac-10?
Beat number two Rice. Should be a very interesting final against North Carolina.
It's all Greek to me, unfortunately.
Well, it's been exciting. Especially for around the country. A lot of people haven't seen the college game on national TV, and ESPN doing a great job of covering it.
I'll blame that on my limited cable subscription. One, two is outside. Ball two.
Nick, you don't have TiVo yet?
No. I only got the first 24 channels. I don't have all those extended channels anymore. I used to have them back in my day.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. TiVo is the greatest invention on the face of the planet. I don't care about anything else. TiVo is awesome.
Runner at first, a 2-2. Up and away, ball three.
No more having to stay up late to see the end of the game.
Exactly. It's really done wonders for me. And I don't have it. I went to someone's house that had it and had to get up, and I was fearful that I'd miss a pitch, and I paused it. And ever since then, I was hooked.
Full count here.
You got to love technology.
Larrie sets and fires back to first. We should get TiVo to sign on as a sponsor at this point.
Oh, man, if that gives out free TiVos, then I'm all for it.
Larrie doesn't have a very quick move to first base, but nonetheless trying to keep Ray on first.
3-2 the count. The payoff pitch, the runner goes. It's taken for ball four.
Again, Ray jumping on the pitch would have been in safe had the throw been thrown to second.
Yeah, he had a great jump over there for us. Randy Ray is a speed demon, to say the least. As you said, coming out of Eastern Connecticut, I should say. 2-for-3 on the air with stolen bases, but obviously that does not go in the book as a stolen base. Only 5'5", and he's a speed demon.
So Mike Larrie, where he's here. About runners at first and second, that tying run at the plate. This one, he could get close very quickly as the Westerners could change everything with one swing of the bat, the pitch. Off-speed breaking ball, is it missing? Ball one to Keeney.
Brett, I appreciate the East Carolina reference. That was my alma mater.
The Pirates, known for their football, nonetheless.
Yes, sir.
Mike Larrie comes to the set, to the belt, the 1-0. Fastball on the outside corner, 1-1 on Keeney, who is 0-2 with a pair of ground outs, was hit by a pitch.
They always had those good matchups with Toledo back in the, when they had the, I believe, what division were they? What conference? They had the
Mighty Mac.
The Mighty Mac. They were always battled, and it was always good to see ECU and Toledo hook up.
The pitch. Swing and a weak kick, bouncing ball. And the batter falls, and there'll be no play. He was tripped up. It looked like Bienhan tripped on his way into third, but there was no play for the shortstop.
Well, actually, that was Randy Ray. Actually,
Miller got in the way.
Here? Very quickly, here comes Kevin Paxton out to argue whatever the call is. We're waiting for it.
Miller obstructed Ray moving to third and literally knocked him down.
Well, there was a slow grounder over to third. Miller went to pick it up, and as he ran over to get the ball, Miller ran into Ray, and it looks like they're going to call Ray out on interference. That's why Kevin Paxton's out to argue. And now it's going to hit it, and there goes.
Oh, my.
Oh, he'll get his 2 cents in now. As he's ejected here.
Oh, my.
This is the first time we've seen a manager ejected here at Cardine's Field, at least in the last 2.5 years.
Well, he's got a good point right there. That was Miller. Miller looked like he threw a shoulder into him to knock him out, to knock him down. So Ray is out on the interference.
Has he been ejected? I didn't see it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, he was. Well, let's see.
Ray arguing with the umpire at home.
Well, Ray is out because of the interference. That's why he's out.
Mm-hmm.
And now, third base coach Andy Wells is getting some sort of explanation. That, as Tim called it, that should be an interference play.
Here's the instant replay on it.
Oh, that was all Miller.
Let's see that one more time if we could before play resumes really quickly.
It looked like Miller was the one that went into it. Miller kind of threw his arms at him, to say the least. I mean, here's the play. Yeah, that looked like it was Miller's fault, but
I don't know if Adams was in the position to see the play. The umpire Wilkins was out right behind the pitcher's mound on the hit, on contact.
And back here once again live, if you're watching on television, as the debate continues.
We're really not supposed to dispute calls with the umpires, but that's a tough one. It looked like Miller. I mean, it could go either way on that one.
It certainly could. It definitely could. Now, was Kevin Paxton ejected there?
Kevin Paxton was thrown out of the game, so it looks like it might be Kevin Long that will take over the managing duties for Danbury.
So a bizarre play here, and a call that certainly could have gone either way between second and third here at Cardines Field. We do have two outs now in the inning, and a runner is at first and second. And it was Keeney who singled. If they try and catch up.
Yeah, Keeney's on first now.
Throw into the plate is a strike in the outside corner to John Delaney, who's 1-for-3 with a double and a strikeout.
But, I mean, it looked like Miller was just, he kind of just stopped and just kind of threw his arms at Ray as he went into him, and Ray was just going, he was in the base path. He was fine.
A tough call for the umpiring crew tonight as the next pitch is outside ball one. Ron Adams, the home plate umpire. John Wilkins, the umpire on the bases here with a very tough decision.
Kevin Paxton was really upset with that and first ejection of the year, and he's that's a tough call.
The 1-1 up and inside ball two.
Delaney leading the teams with leading the Westerners with runs scored with 7. I'm sure they'd be happy to see 3 RBIs go up onto the board for them.
Particularly after that play, if they could redeem themselves a little bit here. It's hit in the end of right field, but it'll go foul and bounce off the roof of the warehouse.
But, I mean, it just comes down to, I mean, did the third, I mean, was the ball even close to Miller is my question. I mean, it looked like the ball was just a slow roller and that Ray was just running towards third and Miller just kind of threw his hands at it, maybe just trying to get the call for him.
Very odd play. Miller is a very aggressive infielder, too, and I'm not sure. Never seen anything like that here at Cardines Field, that's for sure. Larry from the set checks the runner at second. The 2-2 pitch with 2 outs. Bounces in the dirt, good stop by Ruiz, and the count will be full. You don't want to load the bases here. You don't want to load the bases with Ryan Mahoney coming up.
Mahoney's got some pop in his bat, too, but that's if we do get here. And let's see if Larry just comes right at Delaney. Just give him a fastball and see if he can get this on the ground here for his infield, or he doesn't want to walk him, as you said. Let's see if he challenges him right here.
2-on-2-out. Mike Lurie gets the sign. The payoff pitch, the runners go. Swing and a miss. Strike 3, and the inning is over. So after all that, the Westerners trend 2, do not score. Let's pick up Newport Gold's public address announcer, Donald Hanley. 7th inning stretch time here at Cardings Field. Cardines Field, the Newport Gulls lead the Danbury Westerners 5-2 as we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Sunday, July 23rd, 2006, is the New England Patriot Baseball League's All-Star Game at Picturesque Alumni Field in Keene, New Hampshire. Join all 12 NECBL teams, including this year's host, Newport Gulls cross-divisional rival Keene Swampbats, as well as your 2006 Newport Gulls All-Stars for a night of baseball action that can't be missed. For more information about July 23rd's All-Star Game or the New England Collegiate Baseball League, visit www.necbl.com. As we go to the 7th, the new pitcher out there on the mound, Tyler Bishop, here to tell you more about him is Brett Franklin.
Thank you, Nick. Tyler Bishop on the mound. This is going to be his second appearance of the year. More after this pitch.
First pitch to Lance is taking the outside corner, strike one.
Bishop, in his first appearance, has a 4.50 ERA, 2 innings pitched, 1 hit, 1 run, 5 strikeouts, and opponents are hitting 143 off Tyler Bishop.
Lent stands in from the left side of the plate, facing the righty Bishop. A high stretch and a pitch. It's missing outside ball one. The count will even on Andy, who has a home run of the night, his first of the season, was hit by a pitch back in the first. And with that hit by pitch, Lentz should now lead the team in being hit by pitches with five. 1-1 the count on him. Lentz, his last time at the bat, bounced out to the shortstop, and Brad Pipper out for a word with Tyler Bishop here. Perhaps wants to go over the signs, perhaps.
We'll see how. Well, it's been a while since Bishop has pitched, so a good point right there, Nick. And plus, we'll have to see how the fact that Kevin Paxton's been ejected now, see how that changed the game plan. I believe it's Kevin Long that's now is going to be the new manager, active manager now. Kevin Long out of Miami-Dade Community College, powerhouse in division in junior college baseball.
Fastball's in there. Strike two on Andy Lentz.
Bishop's got some pop in that fastball. He really is a hard thrower from Oklahoma. That's where he resides. Real country boy.
From the stretch, the 1-2. Strike three called on the outside corner. Retires Lentz on four pitches.
Yeah, we just mentioned that stat that he pitched two innings and five strikeouts in those two innings. So he's got some pop. And Bishop, he's also a hitter. He's been primarily used as a designated hitter, too. And it was funny story with Tyler Bishop. As I mentioned, he was a country boy. We drove by going to North Adams yesterday, drove through rural New York, and everyone was making fun of the cows. He said, hey, this is my kind of scenery here. I love this. I love the cows and the farmland.
That next delivery is swung on a miss to Brian Mitzel. Mitzel is 0-3 tonight. Brian came into the game, fourth on the team in average at 261. That's dropped down a couple of points. He has a strikeout on his record, and he swings on that one. Foul tips it to the backstop.
Bishop is not beating around the bush. He's just throwing heat, and that's it, right down the middle.
Yeah, he really likes to challenge the hitters, and he was expected to throw earlier today, but as my suspicion, the Westerners signed a new pitcher, and that means Thader got in.
The next delivery is missing low.
Not only does he throw fast, but he works very fast. Taking a very minimal amount of time between his pitches.
1-2, the count to Mitzel. The pitch outside, the count will even up. Mitzel flew out to left, struck out swinging in the third, and grounded out to the third baseman to start off the fifth. Batting here with the bases empty, one out. The goal is out to a 5-2 lead here in the home half of the seventh inning. The pitch is a fastball in the outside corner. A called third strike. Back-to-back strikeouts, both looking for Tyler Bishop, and he is in charge right now.
He really painted that outside corner right there with the straight-up Pete. I think he's just been throwing fastballs this whole time. Really hasn't taken much off of it. And he's just been coming at him with fastballs here and there, and why not? I mean, you know, the Thader and Calzona were just throwing breaking balls, not really much power pitches, and they were getting really hammered. Not so much Thader, but Calzone was. So bringing in some straight heat with Tyler Bishop, and he's been on fire so far.
Jet Ruiz is over one with a pair of walks. Takes the first pitch and swings it on it and fouls it. Foul tips it to the backstop.
Well, Kevin Paxton's definitely found himself a closer with Bishop here. I mean, this guy is throwing heat.
Yeah, he hasn't really been used much, Tim, as we mentioned earlier. And really, it's kind of the same situation with the Gulls are in. They really haven't had a straight closer. They've just been kind of going by bullpen by committee.
He throws from the stretch, and it's swung on and missed by Ruiz. And he's in a hole, nothing in two. The Gulls in danger of being struck out. 1-2-3 here. They've only gone down 1-2-3 once tonight. That was back in the fourth. Tyler Bishop from the stretch, the 0-2. Outside ball one.
It's really the first time he's really gone way outside trying to chase the hitter. He's been really coming at him fastball, as we mentioned.
So Bishop will be charged with keeping the score as it is. The Gulls have a three-run advantage, looking to add on it. The 1-2. Fastball's inside. The count will even up.
Now Bishop, as we mentioned, he hasn't really gotten much time on the mound. Used as the DH sometime. Has a good bat. But maybe this will impress the coaches here for Danbury, maybe lead to him for a relief start.
The 2-2, swinging a foul tip to the backstop in the eighth for the Westerners, middle of the order, due up Mahoney, Pesanello, and McCausland. Well, Lentz and Mitzel both fan-looking here in the seventh. Jet Ruiz has worked the count even at 2-2. Fouled the last one off, steps in, taps the plate. Tyler Bishop gets the sign from Pippa. He's ready. Winds and deals. Swinging a weak hit ground ball up the middle. The second baseman reaches for it, can't get it. It's off his glove. And on at first will be Jet Ruiz.
Yeah, that probably should be an error. I mean, it wasn't much trick on that ball. And I believe it will be an E4.
Yes, it is. We get the award from our official scorer, Alex McLeod. That is an error.
Well, that's error number 20 on the year for Danbury. And I'll just tell you this one thing for Westerner fans. You can't win games when you commit errors like that. And that is three games in a row they've at least had an error. Might be something that they need to look at as we head back home tonight. If they can come out with a win tonight, then maybe it won't be so bad. But it's getting later and later, and we'll have to see how the Gulls can hang on here.
Bishop will pitch to Acadia here. Ruiz at first. Acadia swings and misses the first one, a low fastball.
Kind of wanted to hold his swing up there, but by the time the pitch got there, he was already halfway there. You can kind of see it in his face after he swung.
Ryan Acadia in his first game in a Gulls uniform just picked up. Out of Villanova University. 2 for 3 tonight with a pair of singles and a strikeout. He takes a next delivery outside. Ball one, the count even on him. Acadia does have his first stolen base tonight in a Newport Gulls uniform to go along with those two singles.
Two stolen bases actually tonight.
Oh, that's correct, two. From the set, the 1-1 outside. Ball two. Jet Ruiz reached on the error by McCaslin, takes a short lead at first. Good crowd still here at Cardines Field, as some have left on this Thursday night. Still pretty warm here too in downtown Newport, as a very light fog is paints the outfield. Two outs, 2-1 the count on Acadia. Ryan stands in, Tyler Bishop's pitch. High ball, and it'll be 3-1. Still throwing that fastball. That one was up and way inside. It's a helmet high fastball. Top of the order due up next. Two outs here. The 3-1. Swing and a line shot down the line into left field, a base hit. Rounding second, going into third will be Jet Ruiz. He'll hold up there. And into second with a two-out double is Ryan Acadia. He's 3 for 4 tonight, has three straight hits.
Yeah, that was, I'm surprised Jet Ruiz didn't score on that play. I mean, it looked like he was hobbling all the way through.
My gosh, his wheels were not moving very fast.
I noticed that too. He was trotting to the second base bag and finally picked it up on his way to third. He could have potentially scored. That was very well hit down the left field line. There was no chance of it being caught well to the foul line, nowhere near where John Delaney was standing.
Yeah, that was an interesting play. Jet Ruiz just, he really wasn't hustling down that line. I mean, he was just strolling along. I mean, if it was any other player, I think that would have been an RBI double right there for Arcadia, and then we'd be talking a different score here. But maybe that comes back to haunt the Gulls, because they're still, it's a three-run lead, and you never know here in this game of baseball. So Kevin Long's out to talk to Tyler Bishop. No pitching change, just to calm down Tyler Bishop after cruising to two back-to-back strikeouts. He's Ruiz reached on an error by McCaslin, and then a stand-up double for Acadia. And now 2-1, runners in scoring position with two out, and we go back to the top of the order.
Matt Bouchard is 1 for 3 with a single and a walk.
Mike Coombs has really got to be happy with the lineup changes he's made this tonight.
It's been very effective so far.
Acadia definitely adding some run support to the team, as well as Miller, Lentz in right field. Left field doing the home run this evening.
The pitch, is a fastball taken on the outside corner. Strike one to Matt Bouchard.
This game probably could be a lot closer, but you go back to that to that play over at third base where the interference, which Randy Ray was called out, could have changed the whole game.
Matt Bouchard has knocked in four runs in the year and takes the next pitch in there, strike two, nothing and two from Bishop, who clearly still has his command here. He's only just come in this inning.
Yeah, and that would have loaded the bases with one out, too.
I don't know why Bouchard has been taking the last two. The 0-2 delivery. There's a fastball up high.
Well, if I'm Bishop right here, I'm just throwing a straight heater low. Seeming maybe low and outside. He's been going high these past few pitches. That's why he's been struggling a little bit lately. Just come right at him. Go with the fastball.
With runners on, Bouchard's hitting 300.
And he swings and hits a high fly ball to center field. Backpedaling Randy Ray. Backpedaling still. This ball will go.
It's caught.
And be caught. Be caught out there in center field by Randy Ray, who had to turn and run down that ball out there. Well hit by Bouchard, but not deep enough. The Newport Gulls strand two runners in scoring position. After a seven complete, they lead the ball game 5-2 as we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network. And back here once again at Cardines Field. Newport Gulls fan, this summer be ready for a clash of the Titans at historic Cardines Field. Don't miss the unbelievable baseball action as Team USA comes to Cardines on Saturday, July 1st. The Gulls will be looking for revenge after a painstakingly close loss on Independence Day in 2005. Don't miss the excitement as America's national team, Team USA, plays Newport Saturday night, July 1st. For more information, log on to www.newportgulls.com. So we go to the top of the eighth inning. Six outs left for the Newport Gulls to get a new winning streak going. Of course, Newport falling to the Torrington Twisters in an extended outing last night up in Torrington, Connecticut. 6-4 to score in that game, which seemed to drag on forever as the pitchers worked very slowly throughout it. For the Danbury Westerners here in the eighth, there will be three men due up: Ryan Mahoney, Frank Pesanello, and Chris McAllison. We do have an official attendance report, 1,852, the attendance here tonight. That's the second highest of the season tonight. Quite get the 2,000 here tonight. It's the first pitch to Mahoney is sliced on, hit foul, back and out of play.
Yeah, Mahoney comes into the plate, 0-1-3, single back in the fourth. See how much life Danbury has after a crushing inning last time up.
The pitch. Off the bat and to the backstop.
It looks like Bouchard's moved over to third base, and Adam Tempesta has moved over to second base for the Newport Gulls.
So some defensive changes here. And I would guess Jeff Miller would be out of the game then. The 0-2 is outside, way outside, ball one. With Tempesta in there, you still have Ryan Arcadia at a shortstop. Miller would be out. Pitch, swing, a line shot up the first baseline, a fair ball. And he'll hold up at first. So Mahoney has a leadoff single, and once again, the Westerners get their leadoff man on.
Yeah, nice piece of hitting right there by Mahoney. Pulls that one down the first baseline. Thought it was foul there for a second. Ended up staying fair, and once again, Nick, the leadoff runner for the Westerners are up. So as Tim mentioned, Tempesta will move over to second. Bouchard goes to third, and Miller is out of the game now. So I take it Tempesta will now take over the second slot for the Gulls and will lead off the eighth inning.
Frank Pesanello, designated hitter for the Danbury Westerners, swings on the first pitch and misses it. Strike one, Pesanello, 1-for-3 with a double. Struck out looking his last time in the sixth. Laurie ready, the pitch. It's a breaking ball in there.
The Gulls are 2-0 on the year after leading after seven innings of play.
Quality bullpen, then, if it comes down to that.
Certainly.
Stuff.
Newport has not lost the game after the sixth. The pitch swinging a high pop-up over the netting above the screen and bounces back onto the field.
Once again, Westerner fans, the Westerners are in action tomorrow with the Pittsfield Dukes at Waconia Park. John Foligno will pitch for the Westerners.
Nick Sekas and Brett Franklin will be on the air in that game as this one is fouled back. 0-2 remains the count on Pesanello.
And I'm not too sure when the Westerners hook up again with the Newport Gulls. I believe it's might be next week, if I'm not mistaken.
I'll work on that for you, Brett.
Thank you, Tim. Tim is always on everything here tonight. He's been great. Excellent debut, as the manager would say to the rookie.
Pitch, swing, and a drive to left. Coming on the left fielder, he'll have to play during the hop. Lentz couldn't get to that one as it fell very quickly. And, excuse me, the Dendre Westerners have the first two men on here in the eighth. That'll bring the tying run to the plate.
Another hit for Frank Pesanello was had a double and scored in the second, and then kind of fell flat in the fourth and the sixth with flying out to the right fielder and striking out looking in the sixth. But now 2-1, and in the tying run is Chris McCaslin came up, had an RBI double back in the sixth.
You have to wonder what's going on in the bullpen now as Mike Coombs out to talk with Laurie. This could do it for him. With runners at first and second, nobody out, Coombs may choose to go to the bullpen, and he does. So we'll have a pitching change come to you in this game from Cardinals Field as we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network. Fans want to know more about the Newport Gulls, log on to www.newportgulls.com today and get all the latest stats and standings. Follow your favorite players all season long or find out about the latest giveaways, promotions, and special events. For game day, organizational, and other information, visit newportgulls.com or call 401-849-4982. That's 401-849-4982. The Newport Gulls are a 501c3 nonprofit organization. So here in the eighth inning, we have runners at first and second, nobody out, Mike Lynn, the new pitcher.
Mike Lynn making his fifth appearance on the air, excuse me, with a 1.17 ERA, two saves on the air, 15 in a third innings pitch, 10 hits, three runs, two of them earned, eight walks, 18 strikeouts, giving up one home run, and opponents are hitting 192 off Mike Lynn.
That Mike Lynn strikeout number, he does lead the team in strikeouts.
So definitely an overpowering pitcher in Mike Lynn, and Mike Coombs obviously wanted to save him to the end so there would be no threat later in the innings in case Mike Lurie tired out, which has happened. So we'll see how Mike Lynn holds up here.
That first pitch of his outing is a fastball in the inside corner, a call, a strike.
Lynn teammates with Chris Dominguez, the DH tonight for the Gulls. Teammates at Louisville.
Jet Ruiz just gave a bunch of signs to the infield, working here with nobody out. Runners at first and second. The pitch swinging a hard hit ground ball up the first baseline, snag. It is a fair ball, and running third on the way home and scoring will be Mahoney. It's now a two-run ball game, 5-3 Westerners in at second. It was Pesanola, and McCaslin has a single, three straight hits given up here.
Nice piece of hitting by McCaslin. Faked like he was going to bunt. Everybody was expecting it. That's why Murphy was all the way up in the grass. If he was playing back in his regular position, he would have made that grab and got the out, but he was expecting the bunt, and we're going to have a pinch hitter here as Mike Tamsin's going to hit now.
Tamsin takes the first pitch, strike one, so Tamsin will be in for Pippa, and Pippa on the night had gone 0 for 2 with a strikeout, and actually 1 for 3 with a strikeout. He had a single earlier.
Tamsin's hitting 282.
The pitch, low outside, ball one.
Tamsin out of Northeastern University in Boston, Massachusetts. He's been struggling with the bat as of late, but you know, he said he felt good during batting practice today and looking to get on track. Rough night last night in North Adams, to say the least. And McCaslin getting his second RBI of the night, and the Westerners are right back in it, down by two.
The tying runs are on. Go ahead to run at the plate in the form of Tamsin. Mike Lynn, third pitcher of the night for the Newport Gulls, comes to the set, to the belt, to the plate, swinging a weak hit ground ball, up with it, the third baseman fires a second, out there, on to first, double play.
Lurie just getting some help from the defense.
5-4-3 double play. That was Bouchard to Tempesta to Murphy. Tempesta just came into the game for defensive purposes, and Bouchard, of course, moved over to third base from second. And Bouchard, a normal shortstop, has played two positions tonight. He hasn't played all season, making that good play right there. 5-4-3 double play.
Well, nice piece of running, too, by looks like McCaslin. No, check that. Looked like McCaslin, yeah. No. Pesanello, I should say.
There we go. Swinging a pop up to the right now to play from Dan Biedenhahn. So Pesanello's the only runner left on base. He'll stand at third.
Right. As I was going to say, he kind of hesitated. Bouchard couldn't apply the tag when he went to go throw to second. So he's on third. So Westerners still have some hope here. Can trim the lead even more here with a base hit by Biedenhahn.
A run 90 feet from the plate. Two outs. The pitch. A ground ball roller. Tempesta has it. Will go to first. Inning over. But the Westerners get one back and now are within two. The Gulls 5. The Westerners 3. As we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network. So the Westerners get one back. As we go to the last half of the eighth, the Newport Gulls will have a final chance to add a couple of runs to their lead if they could do it. Adam Tempesta, who was put into the ball game for defensive reasons to replace Jeff Miller earlier, Tempesta will lead off the eighth.
And sorry, Nick, I was just going to say we have a new catcher. Looks like it's... I can't... Looks like it's
Ryan Mahoney.
Ryan Mahoney, correct. So Mahoney, see who's playing first. Might be DiNardo. We'll have to see.
Thank you. Tempesta stands in the pitch. Fastball is in there for a strike from Tyler Bishop, out for another inning. Bishop, who came in the seventh, struck out the first two men he faced and gave an error was committed, and allowing Ruiz to reach and gave up a double to Acadia.
Yeah, so it's Mahoney is catching, and we'll see if we can get a number on the first baseman now.
Nothing in two here. The count on Adam Tempesta. The pitch, swinging a ground ball right to Bishop. He has it and will flip the first, one down.
Mike Tamsin is now the new first baseman. So after a little confusion, I thought I couldn't find the number there in the program, but it's Mahoney is now catching and Tamsin is now at first. So there ends the confusion.
Scott Brown to bat now.
The meat of the goal's order is starting to come up here. Brown, Murphy, Dominguez.
Brown is 1 for 4 with an RBI double back in the first. Swings and lines a shot in the right, a base hit. Brown will be 2 for 5 now as he holds up at first. So the goal is get a man on here with one out for Jim Murphy. Murphy, 1 for 3 with a 2 RBI double. A walk, a stolen base. Drawn it out to the pitcher and flew out to center.
Mahoney is catching and Tamsin is at first base.
Jim Murphy leads the team in runs batted in now with 13. The only team member with double-digit RBI. Throwback at first, and already diving in was Scott Brown. So Murphy stands in from the set. Bishop, his pitch, swing and a miss. Murphy was jammed on a sinker.
Well, give credit to Tyler Bishop coming in. Struggled a little bit back in the seventh, but ended up getting out of the inning unscathed. But he's a real power pitcher after getting back-to-back strikeout.
Nothing in when the count went out. Runner at first. The goal is lead at 5-3 here in the bottom of the eighth. The pitch is another low pitch. Gets away from the catcher. Advancing to second will be Tim Pastor.
That's Brown on second.
Oh, Brown, I should say. Brown. Of course, the Pester bounced out to the pitcher to start off this inning. So Brown, who singled, now stands in scoring position.
Yeah, that'll be a pass ball on Mahoney. And let's see if he can see if I'm pass balls. That might be for the Westerners. That's number eight for the team.
Jim Murphy. Adjusts his shoes outside of the batter's box. Now back in. A tap on the plate. A swing of the bat. And ready. The 1-1 delivery coming from Tyler Bishop. Here it is. Swing and a line shot right to the second baseman. That ball launched off the bat but faded very quickly. Didn't get out of the infield. And Chris McAllison is right there.
Yeah, that looked like Bishop jammed him on that pitch. It really went high, but it really just kind of fluttered in the air. And nonetheless, McCaslin there to wait for it as the runner's still on second. And here's Dominguez, 0-for-4. And I don't know, you got to be careful with Dominguez. He's just looking for that one hit. He's due for one here.
Murphy may have cracked the bat on that one. Chris Dominguez stands in. Runner at second, two outs, the pitch. Low ball one. There's been one home run in this game by Andy Lentz. Came back in the third to lead off that inning.
A Dade County matchup. Dominguez originally from, played his high school ball in Dade County, Florida. Bishop, of course, playing there for his undergrad work.
The 1-0 is outside corner, a called strike. You don't see that every day.
Coach Kevin Long brings the pitching coach, brought a lot of players over from Miami-Dade as Paul Fisher, who is injured right now, but is coaching first base. He's over from Miami-Dade. Actually, he's going to go the U.
One advantage to playing baseball down there is you have so much nice weather year-round. Players up here really don't have that nice winter ball.
Yep. Paul, or PJ as I like to call him, he really doesn't deserve it because he's in Las Vegas all the time, so he's used to it.
A 1-1's outside, 2-1 on Chris Dominguez. From the set, the pitch, swing and a miss, strike two. Dominguez has already fanned twice tonight. Once again, Chris on the season has struck out 19 times.
And Tim, as you would know, junior college baseball in Florida is huge. The competition is unreal. It's like the minor leagues for Division I baseball.
Tyler Bishop's ready. The 2-2, outside ball three.
I mean, Coach Andy Wells, the third base coach from Indian River, he said they got at a junior college game when Georgia came down, they got 9,300 people at Indian River Community College. I don't even know where that is. But that's junior college baseball for you. It is unreal down south.
From the set, Tyler Bishop, 3-2. The count on Dominguez, the payoff pitch. Ball four is outside. And Dominguez is on for the first time tonight. Andy Lentz will bat here. Of course, Lentz hit that home run off of Luke Calzone back in the third. Was hit by a pitch in the first. Bounced to the shortstop to end the fourth. And struck out swinging to lead off the seventh.
You see a reoccurring theme here for Tyler Bishop, able to get two outs and then getting the runner on after and trying to hold the goals to whatever he can. They need to hold him right here. Another run may well put the game away.
Lentz stands in. Runners at first and second, two outs. The first pitch coming to Lentz. Swing and a hot hit ground ball. Up with it, the second baseman drops it, boots it, now throws the first in time.
That's the way to stay with it. Chris McCaslin, stay with it. Don't panic. Get the out, and no damage is done.
Good play by McCaslin. The goals strand two runners and do not score. We go to the ninth. Last chance for the Danbury Westerners next as we continue on the NECBL Broadcast Network. So we go to the ninth, the last chance for the Westerners. Of course, Danbury is 1-0 against the Newport Gulls this season. They did defeat the Newport Gulls up at Rogers Park. 6-3 was the final score in that game. The Newport Gulls stranded 13 runners on base in that ball game. They've stranded 13 here tonight, but they had the advantage 5-3 as we go to the ninth. It'll be the bottom of the order. Randy Ray, number 9 man due up, and then top of the order due up after that for the Westerners.
So last chance effort here for the Westerners. They've been clawing their way back slowly and slowly. So we'll see how they can do it here, if Randy Ray can get on. As the last time he was up, he reached on a fielder's choice, but was thrown out at third base on an interference call.
From the set to the plate, first pitch is outside and high. Ball one from Mike Lynn.
I think that the nine spot has really worked well for Randy Ray tonight. He's been struggling at the top of the order, and this has really suited him well here. He's got two hits tonight.
The 1-0. Strike call on the inside. Corner 1-1. 1,852 fans here at Cardinals Field. Many of them have left it by this point. As the temperature finally begins to drop slightly here, overnight lows are supposed to only get in about in the mid-60s here tonight after the daytime high in the mid-70s. So not a lot of temperature variation here today. The 1-1 is inside, ball two. That's your meteorology update. It's brought to you by the Weather Channel. 2-1 the count here on Ray.
You know, interesting side note, a lot of the broadcasters do double up as meteorologists here on the broadcast, so it's a little-known fact about us. The men behind the mic. That's the next title of my book.
Jet Ruiz out to talk with Mike Lynn here.
But I'll tell you one thing. Newport has done really well. Give credit to the starter, John Deshure. He's really done excellent tonight. Six innings of strong work. And, it looked early that Danbury might jump on him early, but he really settled down and was able to only hold the Westerners to two runs. And the Westerners here, I mean, the story is going to be back on the bus ride home as they left runners on. And probably the same for the Gulls as they stranded 13. Danbury yet again struggling to move those runners in. They should have at least more than three runs on several occasions.
Mike Lurie replaced the shirt, pitched the seventh. And Lynn came in after Lurie gave up two straight singles to lead off the eighth. Next pitch is missing, ball three to Randy Ray. Lynn came in, gave up a single to McCaslin back in the eighth and forced Tamsin, the pinch hitter, to bounce into a 5-4-3 double play and got Biedenhorn to ground out to end the inning. We're here in the ninth. Newport Gulls lead at 5-3. Randy Ray, the center fielder, number 9 man in the lineup tonight, who is 2-for-3, has reached base all three times, reached on a fielder's choice back in the seventh. Takes the pitch, strike called, and the count will be full on him.
Randy thought that was ball four, and he started towards the first baseline, but called back, and crucial pitch right here for Lynn. See if he comes right at Randy.
Lynn comes to the set, to the belt, the payoff pitch. Swing and a foul tip into the mitt, held on by Malico, and he struck him out.
Yep, as we just said, Lynn came right out at Randy Ray. I mean, why not when you got a fastball like that? I mean, come right at him. Don't be afraid. Worst that happens, he puts up another run, but you're still good because there's nobody else on. So,
it was held on by Jet Ruiz, the catcher tonight. Let's see if our camera person can get a shot of Chuck Pavis' seat behind the plate. I see Mayor Trifero has honored us with his presence here, the mayor of Newport. The pitch is a fastball in the inside corner, strike one.
Well, the Westerners have to ask themselves, you know, what if tonight with that play at third base, escorting the manager Paxton out this evening, he got an early trip to the bus.
Well, I guess in the game of baseball, you can't rely on one hit because they strained a lot of runners tonight, too.
The 0-1. Swing and a high pop-up into deep center. Going back is Brown. He'll watch this one bounce off the wall. And rounding first into second with a sliding double is Mo Rivera.
Oh, nice piece of hitting by Mo Rivera. I thought that one was going to be popped up, too. That one was driven all the way to the wall. Mo Rivera finally getting on the hit list here tonight and putting one in. Now runner in scoring position, tying run coming up with the very dangerous Brian Keeney.
So Lynn will have to earn this save very, very carefully here against Keeney. who was hit by a pitch in the first, bounced out twice, and singled in the seventh. Lynn comes to the set. He nods the run of the pitch, swinging a hard-hit ground ball foul up the first baseline.
Well, if you're Brian right there, I figure you take the first pitch. I mean, right now, Lynn just gave up a good shot right there. Take your time. You don't need to place one in. You don't need to get the score right away. Maybe even get on right now and have your fourth man come up, which is Delaney. He's already knocked in a run tonight. Or actually, he was a run tonight.
The pitch. Fastball just missing outside. Ball one. 12 hits and 8 left on base for the Danbury Westerners here tonight.
And that's a crucial stat, is 8 left on base. Way too much for the Danbury Westerners.
1-1, they count on Keeney, the pitch. A little bit outside, ball two.
But I think Tim made an excellent point. You go back to that play at third base. Miller just, and good job by Miller, too. I mean, he just stood his ground. You know, see if you can get that interference call on Randy Way, and it worked to perfection for him.
Lynn checks on the runner, the pitch. Swing and a weak hit ground ball right to him. Lynn has it. We'll have one play at first, two down. Advancing to third is Mo Rivera.
Nice play by Lynn right there. Just take your time. I mean, just let the runner go. I mean, sometimes you see pitchers panic, and they'll throw that ball right away. But nice job by Lynn to just get the out. You know, you got two out. Your defense has been good tonight. And now, last chance as John Delaney comes to the plate.
Danbury down to their last stop. The Newport Gulls lead the ball game 5-3. Here in the top of the ninth, the runner at third, two down. John Delaney is 1-for-4 with a pair of strikeouts and a double.
Hitting 200 with runners in scoring position.
From the set to the plate, fastball in the inside corner, strike one.
Well, that's been the tough spot for Delaney. I mean, he hits the ball hard, but, you know, when it comes with runners in scoring position, he's struggling. This would be a good time to bust out right here.
Nothing in one. The count to John Delaney. Lynn's pitch. Swing and a drive to the right side, but way foul. Very hard hit ball. Foul.
Now that's back-to-back at-bats that Delaney has hit. That's hit some hard balls that just go foul, and hopefully, Delaney was hoping that wind would be pushing hard enough where he'd kept that one fair, but nothing could, but not going his way on that one. And now a chance to close the door here for the Gulls.
Mo Rivera waits at third. Mike Lynn comes to the set. To the bill, the 0-2 pitch. Swing and a ground ball bouncer. Charging the shortstop, fires the first. In time, and the ball game is over. A very close game play at first to retire Delaney, 6-3 for the out. The retires the side and the ball game. The Newport Gulls defeat the Danbury Westerners 5-3. The final score here at Cardinals Field in Newport. The season series is even at one apiece.
Yeah, it looks like we got Kevin Long arguing that call right there. It was a delayed out call. But nonetheless, the outfielders walk out, and Kevin Long still having a long talk, but nonetheless, a tough loss. A strange game, but anyways, it was very competitive as these two teams always hook up.
It was, and the Danbury coaching staff not too happy with the couple of calls made by the umpiring crew tonight. Each one could have gone either way.
But that's the game, Nick. That's
it certainly is.
That comes with the game.
Well, the Gulls and the Westerners are knotted up in the series 1-1 against each other, and we'll see the Danbury Westerners again on the 12th of July.
Still four more matchups between these two teams, all of them coming in the month of July.
Well, if it's any indicator of what these two games have been, it should be an interesting stretch down the road, especially in this tough Southern Division.
Totals and highlights coming up next here on the NBCBL Broadcast Network. Keep it right here. Stay tuned. We have a full post-game show coming up, including down on the field in about 15 minutes. So don't leave. Still much more to come with our Player of the Game interviews next as we continue on the NBCBL Broadcast Network. Again at Cardinals Field, the totals for tonight's ball game for the visiting Danbury Westerners: 3 runs on 12 hits, 1 error, 9 left on base. The Danbury Westerners didn't turn a double play this ball game, but their pitching did strike out 7 Newport Gulls batters. For the Newport Gulls, 5 runs, 11 hits, 1 error, 13 left on base. But that didn't matter as the Gulls did turn 2 double plays, struck out 6 Danbury Westerners to defeat the Westerners, for the first time this season, they're now 1-1, 5-3. The final score of the Newport Ghosts improved their overall record to 8-5. The Westerners fall to 4-8, waiting on the outcome of that key North Adams game, as the Newport Ghosts are 2.5 games back of North Adams. They could be 1.5 games back, depending the result of that game. So the Ghosts win it. Took 3 hours, 7 minutes to play. It was watched by 1,852, the attendance here tonight. Newport Ghosts' winning pitcher will be John DeShirt, who earns his victory tonight in the uniform, and Mike Lynn gets the save for Newport. Down on the field, the remainder of the post-game show next here on the Newport Ghosts and NECBL Broadcast Network, brought to you by the Tigers TV crew. And back here once again at Cardines Field in Newport, happy to be joined by Newport Ghosts player of the game, John DeShirt. John, second win in Newport Ghosts uniform. How was that win out there tonight?
It was great. It was a big win. You know, I came out, everybody played well. We got an early lead, and, you know, we stuck to it. So it was a huge win for us, especially coming off a loss, you know. So it was big for us.
Now, this is your first season playing here in Newport for the Ghosts. How do you like your stay here so far?
Oh, I love it. It's awesome. I mean, the crowd's amazing, the atmosphere, the area. I mean, everything's beautiful. The weather's been beautiful. So, I mean, you can't really ask for more out of a college baseball atmosphere.
Now, this team is on a 12-game straight trip right now here, home and away, including that 5-game road trip, which you fared fairly well on, going 3-2. Wrap it up tomorrow against Manchester, have a final weekend off, finally. How much are the guys looking forward to that?
I think we're looking forward to it a lot. I mean, we've been enjoying playing, and, I mean, it's been great. But, I mean, we're a little banged up right now. We have our catcher's been catching a lot because our backup catcher, or our second catcher, I guess, has got a pulled quad. He played tonight. He played a good game. And so I think we're really looking forward to it, get everything, you know, put the car back together, really, and get it all ready to go again.
And you mentioned Jet Ruiz back in the lineup tonight. What kind of game did he call behind the plate?
A great game. I mean, we were on the same page. You know, it was almost like whatever I was thinking, he was putting down there, you know, so kept me in my rhythm, and I felt good the whole time, and he knew exactly what I wanted to throw when I wanted to throw it.
Well, John DeShirt, you're our Newport Ghosts player of the game. Thank you for joining us, and good luck the rest of the season.
Thank you very much.
We'll be back to wrap things up next here on the NECBL Broadcast Network. And back here one final time at Cardines Field in Newport. The Newport Ghosts defeat the Danbury Westerners here tonight at Cardines Field for the first time this season. 5-3, the final score. They'll play each other another four times, and we'll have all those games for you on the NECBL Broadcast Network, including both games here at Cardines Field on the Newport Ghosts and Tigers TV crew television network. An incredible win tonight as the Ghosts will look to extend their winning streak to tomorrow as they play the Manchester Silkworms for the first time away at Manchester, Connecticut. You can listen to that game live on the NECBL Broadcast Network. As for us, we'll be back here at Cardines Field on Monday night here at 6:20 on the air with the pregame show. First pitch at 6:35. We hope you'll join us then. Let's pause a moment to meet and thank those who made this broadcast possible. The executive producer of Newport Ghosts Baseball and our director, Tom Lehmer. Our associate producer, Mr. Raymond Ballard Sr. Our audio technician and color man tonight, Tim Wine, who did an excellent job in his debut as color announcer for the NGTN. I would like to thank our camera persons, Ryan Betancourt and Jackie Twist, both doing an outstanding job tonight with the cameras. Also, our on-site engineer was Ryan Phoenix, and I would like to thank Brett Franklin for joining us from the Danbury Westerners organization. He did a fine job tonight. For Brett and Tim, I'm Nick Glimmer, bringing you this game from Cardines Field in Newport, Rhode Island. Newport Ghosts defeat the Danbury Westerners 5-3, the final score. Our next broadcast will be on the NECBL Broadcast Network tomorrow against the Manchester Silkworms away and back here at Cardines Field against the Keene Swampbats on Monday night on the air pregame show at 6:20. We'll hope you'll join us then. Until our next broadcast, I'd like to thank you all for watching. The Newport Ghosts win it tonight, 5-3 the final. Until next time, so long, everybody. You love brings out the best in you. Keep your eye, buddy, keep your eye on the dream. You're the best in New England. Well, keep your eye, buddy, keep your eye on the dream. We'll be right back.
Will you live for that moment? One pitch, one swing. You see it in slow motion. You count every scene. And keep your eyes.